Well, hey, y'all. Hey, happy Juneteenth, everybody. Welcome, everyone, to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all, please do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And also, please make sure that you have liked the video on your way in the door. It's akin to wiping your feet. You're fresh out of the snow coming into somebody's house, okay? All right, so listen. If you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel. Make sure you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter when I get to read these books over here in the studio, all right? So with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing. I can't even talk, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way y'all love on me. Child, listen, at first I was going to skip today. I really was, but I was like, nah, I'm nosy. I want to know. I want to know what's going to happen, child. Ooh, Lord have mercy. I need to know. There are some people here that have read the book already, and so they know, but I haven't, and so I need to know. So before I get started, let me see who's here. I know that Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire, is in the building. Thank you so much for being here, darling. Happy Monday to you. Welcome, welcome. I truly appreciate you. Hey, Kim Cash in the building. First one off the gate after moderator extraordinaire. All right. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Wait a minute. She said no. Correction. We nosy. Okay. Listen. The rest of y'all that are in the clouds and the shrubbery, please make sure that you all have liked the video as well. Let me get my time stamp, y'all, so we can get into this thing, because I don't know how long I'm going to be here, but my nosy ass going to try to finish. Stop lying, Saki. You know you're going to try to finish because you're nosy, girl. All right, here we go. Chapter 12. It's been a rough week for us, Alani said. She sat next to Ethic, her hands tucked in between her thighs as she flexed up onto her tiptoes. Her leg bounced. She was nervous. She couldn't control the energy as that leg went to work against the wooden floor, her high heels setting a cadence for the room. Tap, 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 tap. Ethic placed one hand to her knee, and like magic, she calmed. He leaned into her to whisper in her ear, "Relax." It was a command. She followed. Nair sat on the other side of the desk, dressed down as usual. LeBron Lakers jersey over jeans and Jordans on his feet. He finessed the hair on his chin as he took them in. What's the deal, bruh? Was it a rough week or was it a week of Alani overthinking, overanalyzing? Nair asked. Alani frowned and rolled her eyes. So what, y'all go off of one drink and now it's gang gang against little old me in these sessions? She asked, snickering. Women and men's perspectives differ. What's a mountain for you might be a molehill for Ethic, Naya said. It's been a rough week, Ethic confirmed. Alani stuck out her tongue and rolled her eyes, eliciting a smirk from Nair. Ethic didn't miss their chemistry. Alani was lighthearted with Nair, childish even, like they had years and years of inside jokes that kept them bonded. How so? Nair asked. A friend turned out to be foe, Ethic said vaguely as he leaned onto his knees and rubbed the back of his neck, like this conversation took so much, like he had somewhere else to be. His heart wasn't in this session. He was worried about so many things, about Mo, about Messiah coming back, about Raven, about how he hadn't been able to foresee this treachery. And you wanted to punish him for that, Nair said. She didn't want you to. Now it's eating away at you because a man that lets disrespect slide ain't a man. Ethic rolled stern eyes up to Nair. They froze on him, but Nair didn't look down. Church boy had no bitch in him. Ethic was impressed. He had sat across from plenty men who claimed to be tough that couldn't look him in the eyes. He smirked. Nair continued. That's the code you used to live in by, right? Betrayal is punishable by what? Death? Torture? Speak frankly, my man. This is personal counsel. Nothing leaves this room. Ethic's nostrils flared and his jaw locked as he laced his hands. He punched his right hand into his left palm slightly, weighing on Nair's question. No way would he ever answer aloud, but in his mind, an effortless death rang out. Silence is loud, G. Sometimes it's in what you don't say, Nair said. G this, G that. I'm having a hard time reconciling that, Ethic said. Alani marked Ethic with astonished eyes. He was in a mood, had been in a mood all week. She'd never seen him this way, short with people, irritated with redundancy. Even his tone with the kids was different. He was never mean, but his patience had diminished. Like deep thoughts occupied every space of his mind, and they were constantly interrupting. Sex was darker, deeper, harder, motherfucking good. But his touch had changed like the hues of a mood ring. Messiah's betrayal haunted him. Another ghost for her king to carry, only this one still lived and breathed, and she knew that was the thing that bothered him most. Ethic was in the mood for murder. G for me stands for God, Ethic. Black men all over the world have forgotten the God in them. Kings brought over here on slave ships, surviving that, watching our women raped, our babies ripped from the nipples of their mothers, emasculated. I'm here to remind you that you're a God, black, strong, resilient. So when I say that, I mean, my G, my God, because you're made of his making, of his image. You aren't of this walk of life, so you don't know yet the power you have. You know the power the streets show you, but that's man-made. I'm talking about power you were born with that you haven't even accessed yet. Forgiveness is one of those powers. It's how Alani's able to sit next to you right now. Some shit is... He paused, remembering where he was, and he cleared his throat. Some things are unforgivable, but only when it offends you, right? Alani's voice was tiny and full of injury. Or is it about Raven? When it pertains to Raven, it's unforgivable, but when it's about my hurt, that should be forgiven? Ethic felt the temperature rise in the room. He had fucked up. He had placed expectations on her that he couldn't meet himself. A double standard. He knew it, but shit shook out that way sometimes. Over Raven, it shook out that way every time. That's not what I'm saying, he said. I'm here with you. I'm trying to be a better man for you. That old way is still in me, fighting that. It feels like pulling teeth. It doesn't just go away overnight. And it won't. Change is slow. Fast change is an illusion. Whoever this friend is, he's worth your forgiveness. I know that simply because you're hurt by this. Betrayal from a stranger, from somebody you don't love, doesn't affect you. You loved him. And to love a person, you have to know that they will hurt you one day because we're human. We're imperfect. So hurt is a part of the equation. That's what forgiveness is for, to keep the people you love in your life after they've damaged you. Forgiveness is for you, not them. Ethic sat back in his chair in deep contemplation. There's discord between the two of you, tension that this situation brings up that affects the two of you. You've been exchanging the tension back and forth, trying to exhaust it out of you through sex, passing demons back and forth. It's time to refrain. It's time to cleanse and connect spiritually. The dating. Y'all started that yet? So much has happened. We haven't had time, Alani said. Make time, Nair said. Ethic lifted from his chair, impatient, irritated, suffocating in this church where he was thinking of the worst. He just needed some air. He shook Nair's hand. Good seeing you, G, Nair said. Ethic placed his hand on the small of Alani's back as she stood. Let her out of the office. They didn't speak. Ethic didn't like this feeling. This disdain he felt from her, like her resentment was resurfacing because of what he'd said. He followed her to the car, both hands tucked in his Armani slacks and his eyes toward the ground as his thoughts ambushed him. He walked her to the passenger side, and when she reached for the door, he pushed it closed and forced her against it. I'm sorry for my energy this past week, for brooding, for making it uncomfortable for you, he said. Tell me about Raven, she whispered, about what happened to her, about what she meant to you, about what I mean to you. It kind of feels like I'm a consolation prize. You're not, he said. She looked off to the side. He put gentle fingers to her chin, steering her back before she got lost in her thoughts, before she amplified their problems in her heart. You're not, he repeated. I just can't talk about that. One day, but not today, and I need you to understand that. Alani didn't speak. Her brows were dipped, her body language stiff. He nodded. She was on her stubborn shit, her Alani shit. He opened her door, and when she was inside, he closed it and then made his way to the driver's seat. Silence filled their car ride, and when she saw him merging onto the freeway to head back to his home, she said, take me home, please. His brows lifted and stunned, but he didn't argue with her. He changed course, headed to her house. Perhaps a night apart to clear the air and to get his mind right would do them both well. I want to take you somewhere, he said, for the weekend. Pack a bag. I'll pick you up tomorrow. You sure this is the best time to go away overnight? The kids. will stay with Lily. I have Mo come home for the weekend. Morgan just went through so much. It feels like you should be home in case she needs you. And Lily has a family epic. So you don't want to go? Just say that because all the rest just sounds like excuses. You said slow. If this is fast, I can fall back. If that's what you want to do, Alani said. Ethic shook his head. Stubborn ass. Alani could be so damn difficult at times. She was work. She was the hardest work he'd ever done. She rolled her eyes. Call Morgan and make sure she's fine with you leaving town for a few days and then bring the kids here. Nanny would love the company and I'll feel better about leaving her. Ethic nodded. Fine, he said. Fine, she shot back. Hey, one word jarred her attention. You keep acting like you need to be fucked. And that celibacy shit we just promised Nair is getting tossed right out the fucking window. Ethic licked his lips like remnants of her pussy lingered there, and Alani blushed so hard that even her fingertips heated and then turned red. He pushed open the door and rounded the car to open hers. She stood and attempted to walk past him. He caught her hand and pulled her back, a hand to the small of her back and one gripping her chin. He kissed her. Alani didn't want to like it, but damn if she didn't love that shit. He released her. And she gave up a stubborn smile. Friday, Miss Hill, he said. She nodded, and he watched her waltz up the walkway. That attitude should be gone by then, he shouted after her. Alani turned to him, lifting an eyebrow in defiance, then walked into her house. Not until she was safely inside did he get into his Range Rover and drive away. And that's the end of that chapter. I'm so sick of this bitch. Oh, you want him to fuck you? You want him to stir it up, beat it up even, but then you don't want to follow corrections and shit. Girl, go to hell with your confused ass. You fucking weirdo. Anyway, child, listen, let me just, I can not with this girl. I want to punch her on the damn back. All right, Kim said, I'm over here acting like I haven't read it, but it's nothing. Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Hey, hashi tashi, grasshopper. Hey, learning. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Marva. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Thank you for that compliment, Marva. Aw, y'all too kind. Listen, Linda. Got me over here all blushing and shit. Oh, shucks. Now my cheeks all rosy and red. Go to hell, because in 15 minutes, y'all will be like, uh-uh. So I can get on my fucking nerves. Oh my God. All right, let me get my next timestamp, child. Here we go. Let me see. Let me see. Let me see. Chapter 13. Ethic placed hard-bottom Gucci loafers to the tile floor as he stepped into the hospital. The place had a peculiar smell. He had lived in it for weeks when he was trapped between these walls after being shot. It reeked of death. Of love's death, ravens. That was the problem with small towns. It only had one of everything, one hospital, one jail, one courthouse. The memories, all the deaths he had collected along the years had occurred under this very roof. It put him in a foul mood. Ghosts clung to the corridors of this building. Ethic could feel them. He had come too close to being one of the souls lost here, so he knew they dwelled sight unseen but felt. If one took the time to still long enough to acknowledge the energy, it came with a chill down one's spine or the raised hair on the back of one's neck, even the feeling of company occupying a space that appeared desolate. In this hospital, those feelings came with company, the presence of lives lost when medicine failed. Ethic wanted to get out of there as quick as possible, but he had to see one man first. He passed the nurse's station and recognized the nurse he had paid to look after Nanny. No words were needed for her to lift out of her seat. He walked by her without acknowledgement. The sound of the fire alarm erupted moments later, and Ethic watched as the nurse rushed to the armed guard standing in front of one of the rooms. Everyone must clear the floor, she said. I'm sorry, he's handcuffed to the bed. All patients will be looked after by staff, but when that alarm goes off, the floor must clear. She ushered the guard to the elevator and then walked away. Ethic waited until the elevator doors closed before taking a casual stroll down the hall and sliding inside the room. The dimmed lights cast a shadow over the room, and a body lay beneath white sheets on the hospital bed. Who's there? Ethic stepped out of the darkness that concealed him and stood next to the bed. A nigga you've been trying to see, apparently, Ethic replied as he stared into the eyes of Bookie Grant, Messiah's father, Benny Atkins's adversary. Bookie's eyes doubled in size as Epic stood over him. You sent Messiah for me. After I fucking murdered your first son, you sent your second son to my doorstep, knowing that I would murder him too. What type of man sends his son to do his dirty work? Epic asked. Fuck you, motherfucker, Bookie sneered. Epic scoffed. That's what you do, right? Fuck men, molest boys, Messiah? Epic asked, darkness dancing in his eyes as the thought of how many young boys he had taken advantage of over the years before being locked up. That's why he did it, right? Epic asked. Because you stripped your son of his manhood when he was a kid. He's terrified of you and you use that against him. Niggas like you, Epic stated in disgust, shaking his head. He clicked a button on the beeping heart monitor beside the bed and the green lights on the interface turned off. You like molesting little boys, your son, your own flesh and blood. Bookie shook uncontrollably as Epic spilled his darkest secrets. That boy's a fucking liar. Epic slipped a leather glove over his hand and covered Bookie's mouth and nose with it before Bookie could finish his sentence. He pressed so hard that Bookie couldn't breathe. That boy's my fucking brother, Epic sneered. He kicked and bucked in the bed as Epic stared him in the eyes with an expression so calm that it seemed demonic. You should have left well enough alone, Epic said. Any nigga that ever sent for me got shipped back in a body bag. You knew better. Bookie's eyes bulged out of his head as Epic watched the blood vessels burst one by one, making the whites of his eyes streak with red. Bookie was cuffed to the railing of the bed, and it clanged violently as he struggled. He reached for Epic's hand with his one free hand, but Epic's hand was pressed so tightly against his airway that Bookie couldn't steal one sip of oxygen. Feel every second, Epic whispered. Epic felt the strength leaving Bookie's body, and he felt no remorse. He was a man who didn't enjoy murder. He committed it when necessary, only when provoked. But this one, he reveled in. He indulged in it until every single sign of life was gone. He removed the glove and put it in his pocket and then walked back into the hallway, blending in with the hustle and bustle of the staff. Epic bypassed the nurse and slid an envelope stuffed with $100 bills into the front pocket of her scrubs, never stopping his stride as he headed to the stairway. She would discover the body and remove the pieces of tape she had placed over the cameras that recorded movement on the wing where Bookie had occupied. It was a flawlessly executed kill, and as Epic walked out of the hospital, he hoped it would be his last. And that's the end of that chapter. Yay, Bookie dead. So now, perhaps Messiah can come back. I mean, I don't know, but we got to get Wosie under control, because that bitch is, she's a feral cat on the prowl, just absolutely out of fucking control. And a weird-ass bitch on top of that, because you loyal to him, and he probably molested her too, but I don't mean of his pension. Boys, but still and all, anyway, child, listen. I don't even know what to say, child. Listen, listen, listen. Okay. Oh, thank you, Marva. Hey, Choco Chip. Thank you so much for being here, darling, and for bringing the good vibes with you. I appreciate you. All right, let me keep going here, child. Yeah, Bookie gone, child. He gone. He did to the hospital bed. Oh my God, poor Bookie. Y'all, I'm bullshitting. Fuck that nigga. He's a piece of shit. All right, so let me get this next chapter rolling here. Lord have mercy. Chapter 14. Ethic rolled his Range Rover to a stop in front of Alani's house. He stalled as he placed the car in park. Anxiety filled him. He was nervous. It was a foreign feeling. The hollow pit in the bottom of his stomach, the sweaty palms. He had never felt this way before. It wasn't until this very moment that he realized he had never taken a woman on a real date. The streets hadn't left him much time for courtship. He had enjoyed time with women, hotel rooms and sex, breakfast afterward. But he had never engaged in wooing a woman. It wasn't required. Women were taken with him at Hello, and not because he tried, but because he was just a force, a presence, a marvel of a man that made women want to experience him between their legs. He filled their hearts effortlessly with his authenticity, but only a particular few had the power to occupy his in return. Not one had ever held that expectation of him. dating. Women never required that of him. It was hello and then orgasms, nothing in between. Alani's prerequisite was different. It was a challenge, and it brought out the young man in him. He glanced over at the bouquet of long-stemmed lilies. A phone call to Nanny had given him the leg up on Alani's favorite flower. It felt corny, showing up with flowers, especially from a local boutique. They were average at best, not like the Le Fleur roses he had given her before, but he had taken the time to stop at a local florist to pick up one himself. The florist had taught him how to arrange the bouquet personally, because if he was going to gift them, he wanted each petal to have meaning, to be selected by him for her. "Are we going in?" Easy asked impatiently. Ethic looked up at the house and then took a deep breath. Fucking nerves, he thought, feeling juvenile. "Yeah, big man, let's go," Ethic said as he stepped out of the car and opened the back door for his children. They spilled out, and Easy bolted for the porch while Bella strolled to her own pace as earbuds drowned out the world around her. Nanny came spilling out of the front door as if she had been waiting for their arrival. "My babies," she greeted. "Hi, Nanny," Easy shouted as he ran into her, wrapping her in a rough hug. Ethic paused at the bottom of the steps when he heard Easy use the term of endearment. Only Alani called her Nanny. She pronounced it like Nanny because she hadn't been able to say auntie as a baby, and it had just stuck. But no one else called the old woman that. Everyone else called her Pat. Ethic called her beautiful. To his children, she was their nanny as well, because the old woman smiled as she embraced them. "Careful, Easy," Ethic said as he climbed the steps and leaned down to kiss the old woman's cheek. He handed her a bouquet of African daisies, the same flowers he had filled her hospital room with day in and day out. "Thank you, Ezra," Nanny said as she patted his cheek. Ethic turned to his children. "Do I need to tell y'all to behave?" "No, I don't, because y'all know better, right?" "Boy, hush," Nanny said. "Kids will be kids. If they're too quiet and boring, I might as well be hanging with old folks. I need their energy around here. We're gonna have us a good old time, ain't that right?" She looked to Bella and tapped the tip of her nose. Bella beamed. "Get on in the house and don't put y'all dirty shoes on my new carpet. Take them shoes off at the door," Nanny fussed. Ethic's heart warmed. It all felt like family. The chastising, the elderly figure spoiling his children, ignoring his rules and making up her own because she was the boss. He loved this shit. He would do anything to preserve these bonds his children were making. They deserved them, and he yearned for them. "Is she ready?" he asked. "She damn well should be. She been getting ready all morning," Nanny fussed. "Come on in, baby." Ethic hesitated, and Nanny's brow crinkled as she watched him halt at the threshold like someone had put a hex on his feet. "You're welcome here, Ezra. Get on in here now," she said. Ethic's heart lurched as he stepped inside. He had such bad memories between these walls. He had committed the ultimate sin here, and being here was like holding up a mirror to see the monster that he kept dormant inside. His kids' shoes were strewn about by the front door. They were heading to the living room. "Yo," he called to them. They turned. He pointed to their mess and they backtracked instantly, lining the shoes up neatly. "Thank you. Daddy can't get no love before I leave." They gave him quick hugs and then rushed off with Nanny to the living room. Ethic stood by the front door, not daring enough to venture further. As he waited, butterflies filled him and he paced slightly until he heard, "Hey." He turned and looked up to find Alani standing there. "You're a fucking vision, baby," he said. Alani blushed and smiled so wide that he had to put a hand over the left side of his chest. She was shooting invisible arrows at him. He felt each one as she descended the stairs. "It's just jeans, Ethic," she said with a blush as she rolled her eyes, bashful from his appreciation. She looked down at the dark denim, skin-tight pants and slightly lighter-toned denim button-down shirt. "You said casual," she said. "Casual looks fucking amazing on you," he complimented as he pulled her hand, whipping her body into him and putting a hand behind her neck. He stood there, silent, eyes taking her in, every inch of her face as she gazed up at him. Words weren't needed. She knew what he was doing, taking his time to store her image in his memory. "Appreciated," he called it. Long extensions fell down her back in bouncy curls, and Ethic's hands moved up, playing with the baby hair that rested at the nape of her neck. "Don't you put your hands in my hair, boy," she warned. "It took hours for me to look this good." He chuckled and nodded. That was black girl shit. Black girl rules. Black girl talk. He respected it and lowered his hand. He handed her the flowers and then studied her reaction as a genuine smile spread east to west on her face. She closed her eyes and brought the bouquet to her nose before taking a deep breath. She liked them. You could tell by the way the wrinkles in the center of her forehead disappeared, and she sighed to release the fragrance from the breath she held for an extra beat. She was simple to please. He liked that. It meant she could ride through a drought with him if he ever needed her to. She would never see that day because if Ethic knew nothing else, he knew how to make money. But it was good to know she wasn't materialistic. It was the nuances he would pick up while dating her, the little things. Maybe she was on to something. Thank you, she said. You ready to get out of here? She nodded. Just let me put these in some water and see the kids first. The kids, he thought. It stuck out every time she said it. Not his kids, but the kids. He was trusting her more and more to be a part of their lives. The more she said it, the more he felt like she just may be around to stay this time because, well, she had the kids to think about. It warmed him every time. She frowned as she slipped into her jacket. What? She asked as he stared at her with a pinched brow. He was so introspective, so brooding. He shook his head. He had to remember not to show how amazed he was by her. Nothing, he replied, as he took slow steps behind her toward the living room. So y'all just not gonna show me no love? Alani asked when she spotted them. Sorry, Alani, Bella called from the rocking chair as she sat with lotto slips in front of her, filling in random numbers. Nanny had her predicting the lottery numbers, and Alani smiled because she used to love to do that when she was a child. Easy ran into Alani, hugging her. Hey, big man, she greeted. Can I come on the date? Easy asked. Alani shook her head. Not this time, but I promise you and I will have our own day to spend together one day this week. I'll surprise you one day after school. That sound legit? She asked. What about me? Bella asked. We already have Saturdays, B, Alani responded. This one is just for me and Easy. You can do me a favor and put these in water, though. She extended the flowers, and Bella rose from her seat to retrieve them. We'll see y'all Sunday, okay? Ethic watched Alani command his children as if she had been around them their entire lives. They didn't resist her. They didn't backtalk. And if they did, she shut them down with love, not malice. She was stern yet loving, kind, and unbelievably patient. Dolce had been around them forever and didn't have the shorthand that Alani showed with them. Easy returned to Nanny's side, and the couple turned to leave. Love you, Daddy. Love you, Alani, Bella called. Ethic felt tension fill his chest. That was pressure. He didn't want that for Alani. The push to respond just because his child had put her on the spot, but an effortless, I love you more, fell from Alani's lips as she snatched up her purse. Ethic wanted to fuck her. It was shit like that. It made dating seem trivial. Ethic needed to marry this woman. He wanted to carry her upstairs and root himself so deeply in her that separating them would be impossible. He wanted to create family with her, legacy. He wanted to hear her scream his name first while he beat it. Then, while she birthed the result of the seed he would plant. Love you, baby girl, Ethic added. Then he took Alani's hand and led her to his car. He opened the passenger door for her, and she slid into the seat. She turned to put on her seatbelt, and when she turned back, Ethic was there, taking her tongue into his mouth. She melted into him, moaning slightly as he awakened her body. Tastes so fucking good, he whispered. How am I supposed to not touch you? Now you're on that bullshit. Alani laughed as she placed a hand on his cheek. Kisses are fine, she whispered. He said no sex. Ethic bit his bottom lip like it would be impossible, and Alani felt herself turn red. No sex, he confirmed with a head nod. Okay, no sex. He closed her door and then rounded the back of the car before joining her inside. Pause. Let me tell y'all something. Soon as he get her ass somewhere and she get naked, I can see him whipping it up like egg whites. You heard me? Ethic placed his hand on her thigh, one hand gripping the steering wheel, and he pulled off. That one hand made her feel so secure, like there wasn't another person in the world that could get to her as long as it was placed there. Ethic was a man that provided reassurance. As long as the two of them were right, everything else around them could be all wrong, and Alani wouldn't feel it. So, where are we going? She asked. Somewhere beautiful. The scenery has to match my company, he said. She replied, as if she was figuring something out all of a sudden. What? he countered. That explains why you took that other bitch to a diner, she said, with a roll of her eyes. Ethic snickered. You're ruthless, he stated, with a shake of his head. Over you, I absolutely am, she admitted. She rolled jealous eyes out the window. She hated that she had even brought her up. It killed me seeing you with her, seeing you with green eyes, too. Like, it gutted me, Ethic. He kept his eyes on the road, but he responded, sometimes you find a spot that's exquisite. The sun shines on it just right. You just don't want to see anything more. You're fine. Right there in that spot, you're satisfied, and you forget about all the other shit you've seen before. His grip on her thigh tightened, and Alani sighed in relief as she looked out her window. They drove for so long that Alani drifted to sleep. When she felt the car stop, she lifted her head and rubbed her sore neck. Where are we? She asked as she looked outside her window in wonder. A beautiful, large, white house with wide shutters and a wraparound porch sat in the distance. Fields surrounded it, and a large red barn sat on the property. Creaking from the porch swing whined through the air as the sound of water washing ashore added harmony. You wanted me to date you. This is our first date, he said. Second, she corrected. I made you dinner, remember? Nah, that don't count. We washing that. Our time begins here. It's important, the starting over and such. She took pause to meet his earnest gaze, and she nodded. Ethic climbed out of the car, and she waited for him to open her door. He pulled it open and then reached into the back seat for her bag. He took her hand, and Alani felt it. The connection, the passion burning from his fingertips to hers. He loved her so much that he made her feel like wrong was right. She followed him to the house, and when they climbed up the porch's stairs, she reached for the handle on the door. She pressed down and then pushed. It's locked, she said, frowning. Is someone expecting us? Ethic came up behind her and went into his pocket, producing a key. He opened the door. You have a key? I should. I own it, he said. You own this farm? She asked, confused. He nodded and pushed inside the home, leaving Alani standing perplexed on the front porch.
Yeah, child.
She eased through the door to the stuffy home. Stale air lingered inside as if the door hadn't been opened for months. She looked at him stunned. What? He asked. Alani smiled while shaking her head. He was the opposite of what every woman would assume him to be. He was cultured and worldly and unique. With him, she would have to expect the unexpected because everything she assumed of him was wrong. It's really beautiful. I just didn't expect you to own a farm. Are there animals? She asked. He nodded. I don't run it. I pay a nice old woman and her husband to tend to it. I just believe in owning land. You never know when you'll have to live off the land. The world is crazy. Politics, war, racism, cops killing black boys every day with no retribution. One day, I might have to retreat here. I want my family to always have a place to come that's removed from it all, if it ever comes to that, he said. And yeah, there's animals. I want to show you something. She followed him through the kitchen and out the back door as they headed towards a huge wooden barn in the back. Alani tiptoed over mud puddles and dirt. Ethic, my shoes, I just bought them, she said, hating to sound like that girl. But she had spent a grip on the red-soled bottoms to try to match his fly. She'd be damned if she got mud all over them. He turned in surprise and then eyed the shoes on her feet. They didn't even look like something she'd wear. Well enough to realize she had put effort into trying to impress him. This date meant something to her. The shoes, the hair, her comments about Dolce and Yaya, Nanny's complaints about the time it had taken Alani to prepare. Alani had tried to be what she assumed he liked. She had tried to be like them, bad bitches, she had called them once. It broke his heart that she felt the need to even compete, but he didn't want to embarrass her. She had always come off so strong and self-assured. He saw holes in her, ones he hadn't put there that he would need to fill. Can't have that, he said with a wink. Hop on my back. She shook her head, smiling as she grabbed his shoulders and jumped up. She wrapped her arms around his neck tightly as he bounced her higher. Then she put her lips near his ear, biting it softly. Then he carried her into the wooden structure. Alani looked around in wonder. Ethic, you have horses? She asked as she hopped down, instantly forgetting all about the shoes. She covered her mouth with both hands to contain her excitement. Her eyes were wide like a child seeing an elephant for the first time at the circus. You own fucking horses? One for every person I love, he said. Alani counted the horses. There's six horses, she said. One for each of my kids, one for Easy's mom, and one for me, she asked. She didn't miss how he included love. He always included their dead son. He always included her. Her eyes watered. He nodded as he opened the stall. Inside was a white Mustang standing tall and strong. You bought me a horse? She asked. She doesn't have a name yet, Ethic said, as Alani crept inside. The horse huffed, and Alani jumped. She's not used to people. I buy them wild. I pay a wrangler to train them, domesticate them. She's a stubborn girl. She hasn't allowed anyone to touch her. Horses are empathetic creatures. They're therapeutic, but it takes the right person to connect with them. Ethic went to touch the Mustang, and she bucked, lifting her hind legs. Alani jumped back. Alani inched forward, reaching out with trembling fingers. The horse huffed and tried to back up, but the stall she was berthed in stopped her. I don't know anything about horses, she whispered, her voice catching on fear because she expected this creature to buck at her any moment. That horse doesn't know anything about you either, Ethic said in a low tone as he leaned back, crossing his arms across his broad chest as he witnessed the interaction. I think you're on fair ground. Alani couldn't tear her eyes off the animal as she took a step closer until just her fingertips rested on its muzzle. She pulled back as the horse reacted, neighing, backing up. The horse was panicking, and Alani was too. Her heart was beating so rapidly it felt like it would jump out of her chest. She feels trapped. She's sad. Look at her eyes, Ethic, Alani whispered. She knew what that felt like, and the wetness that shone in the huge auburn eyes of this beast couldn't be anything other than emotion. I'm sure she is. She lost her fowl. Or is it foal? Yes, it's foal. Sorry. Fowl is the goddamn chickens and birds and shit. She lost her foal, Ethic informed. Foal? Alani asked as she turned to meet Ethic's gaze. She was pregnant. The foal didn't make it, he said. Alani's eyes snapped back to the horse, and her stomach plummeted. It suddenly felt like she was looking into a mirror. It's okay, she whispered. She rested her palm on its muzzle and brought her other hand to the horse's neck. It's okay. The horse huffed again and again as Alani rubbed. I know, she scoffed in disbelief. She knew that feeling. She had lost her foal, too, to foul play, and it was unfair and devastating and crushing, and it hurt so fucking bad that Alani's eyes watered. You are beautiful, she said, as she rubbed its coat. The horse calmed at her touch. Alani felt her heart calm, too. She likes you, Ethic said. Wow, Alani whispered breathlessly. Her heart swelled as she stepped closer, resting her head on the side of the horse's long neck and rubbing gently. I can hear her heart beating, she whispered. It's incredible. She's strong. She's heartbroken, but she's strong. Alani's eyes closed. She's going to be just fine now that she has someone to love it away. Alani wasn't speaking about the horse anymore, and Ethic stood back, watching a lovely fucking sight. She needs a name, Ethic said. Alani turned to him. Is she really mine? Ethic nodded. She's really yours. Kenzie, she said without hesitation. Her name is Kenzie. Ethic nodded. He had known that would be the name she would choose before it even fell off her lips. Can I ride her? Alani asked. Not yet, Ethic said. There are others here you can ride. She would throw you. You gotta let the trainers tame her first. She wouldn't even let you put a saddle on her right now. She's used to being wild. She doesn't trust anyone enough to be tied down, Alani whispered. She's afraid she'll end up hurt. Alani looked to him and he nodded. Her chest rocked and a sob escaped her lips. Nobody's gonna hurt her here. I know she's been hurt before, but it won't happen ever again, Ethic said. His stare penetrated her and Alani rushed into his arms. Fuck her hair. He fisted it as he pressed her into his chest while she cried. I promise. Ethic knew she came with baggage. Some he had put on her. Some other men before him had left her with. He would help unpack it, all because she was home. She'd never need to carry it around again. Through every storm, his roof would cover her. His walls would protect her. She pulled back and lifted her lips to his. Their kiss was deep, desperate, sloppy. He placed his hands under her ass and scooped her as her legs wrapped around his waist. I don't know if you'll call me after today, she whispered between kisses. What? Ethic pulled back in confusion, trying to assess her meaning. He frowned, contemplating hard as she panted in lust. I'm a whole hoe out here because I'm fucking on the first date, she whispered. Before reaching her hand down, massaging his erection through the fabric of his jeans. Is that right? He asked. She nodded, sucking dick and all. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, that's cute. I told y'all. She said, I don't know if you gonna call me after today, because I'm a whore out here. We fucking and I'm sucking, you hear me? That was cute. Oh, my goodness, child. Listen, Linda. Ethic was like, is that right? Okay. Hey, Nordic Grand Rising. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. Not you was busy cussing a simple bitch out. Uh-uh, not a slow bopper for Christ, child. You got to give him a little bit of grace. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I know the horse, right? Aw. All right, so let me get my next time stamp. Whew, dude, Jesus, child. We ain't read nothing but 3 chapters, and we already been up here 46 minutes. And we have, okay, it's cool. We gonna make it, y'all. And then I get to have the rest of my day to myself. Nosy ass. All right, let's get it here. I don't know what y'all doing, but I'm chilling. Shit. Mm-mm. All right. Chapter 15. Ethic carried her in his arms as he took heavy steps back toward the house. She commanded his focus, devouring his tongue as he held her securely, hands on her ass. He groaned because her kisses did something to him. They set him on fire and put a need in him that only she could fill, needs that they had been restricted from satisfying because they were on a quest to connect spiritually. His spirit was telling him to fuck her. The way she was whimpering just from the taste of his thick tongue told him her spirit was saying the same. The yard was full of mud from yesterday's rain, and Ethic needed his eyes. He needed to detach his lips from hers so he could navigate through the mess. He was dying to get her back to the house, to a bed, because his dick was already making plans. The taste of her tongue made him crave another piece of her flesh, his favorite set of lips. He missed them. He was starved for them, but Alani was too aggressive. She was all over him, practically climbing his frame to try to keep her pussy glued to the friction of his hardness. Ethic lost his balance. Oh, shit, he muttered in alarm as he held her tight to his waist, turning his back so he landed on the bottom and she landed on top. Mud covered them as Alani laughed, hollered, screamed in amusement. It had been a long time since she had laughed so hard. It came from her gut, so heavily that it hurt. It hurt so good. Ethic shook his head. A low rumble echoed in his belly, laughing too. Alani picked up a glob of mud and smacked it against his cheek before kissing him again. He nodded and winced as she spread those dirty fingers all in his beard. Nice, he grumbled. Nothing's wrong with a little bit of mud, she snickered. I like it a little dirty, Ethic clipped her. Ah, my weave! Ethic took her chin in between the U of one hand and pierced her with his stare. Fuck the hair. Fuck the shoes. Fuck everything you think you need to keep my attention. You got it. You got me. I ain't the catch, baby. You are. Let me work to keep you, not the other way around, okay? She nodded then. Splat! A face full of mud. I'ma fuck you up, he snickered. She scrambled to her feet, laughing her ass off. She took off running. He gave chase, catching her with ease and putting her over his shoulder. She went kicking and screaming in laughter as he carried her into the house. He placed her on her feet, and the smile on her face was brilliant. The one on his felt foreign. It had been a long time since he had been this at ease. His children were safe. He had a woman who loved him. He had never had both things simultaneously, and it felt amazing. He was a simple man to please. Those two things were all he required. I'm sorry, she laughed. He wiped mud from his face, even digging some out of his ear as he grimaced. He removed his shirt. A sight of chocolate and abs made her throat constrict. She swallowed down lust. Then he stepped out of his jeans, then peeled off his socks, then his drawers. He stood before her. The arrogant smirk on his face told her he wasn't shy as he covered his manhood, unable to hide it because something so massive couldn't be concealed with one hand. She undressed and stood there as his eyes took her in. She didn't cover anything. For the first time ever in her life, she felt beautiful in her skin. If Ethic liked it, it had to be enough because he was the prototype of a perfect man. And if a bitch disagreed, fuck her because Ethic was perfect to Alani. Nye said no sex, Ethic stated. Okay, she said with a shoulder shrug as she walked over to him. Let's see how long you keep singing that same tune. I'm walking around this house all day naked until I get what I want. I'll enjoy the visual, Ethic chuckled, but you ain't getting no dick. Alani wrapped her arms around his neck and kissed his chest and then ran a flat tongue up the center of his neck. She felt his manhood react. Let's get you cleaned up, he said, voice throaty, needy, as he tapped her ass. He led the way out of the kitchen and up the stairs of the country house, grabbing her bags along the way. Alani grew distracted at the opulence of the remodeled home. It was magnificent. Every room she passed was perfectly designed. When they reached the bathroom, she swooned. It was the size of her living room. Tub or shower? He asked. I've showered with you before. I want to bathe, she answered sweetly. She dug in her scalp. Do you have scissors? He pulled open a drawer near the sink and handed them over, and then went to fill the tub. Alani stood in front of the mirror, cutting away at the extensions as Ethics submerged inside the large jacuzzi tub. Come here, he said. Give me a minute. I just need to get this out. There's mud everywhere. Come. It was in order, the one she followed without protest. Every time she submitted, walked toward him, scissors in hand. When she got to the edge of the tub, he pulled her into the water. She sat between his legs, leaning her back against his chest. Give me the scissors. She passed them, and to her surprise, she felt his hands in her hair. She looked over her shoulder. You know what you're doing? She asked. Nah, but you can tell me. Shit can't be rocket science, right? He asked. She smirked. Just find the thread near my scalp and cut. Only the thread, and carefully, she instructed. Ethic went to work as she leaned against him. She couldn't believe he was helping her with this. Why'd you put this in your hair? He asked. She shrugged. Don't do that, he said. We not keeping things from one another. Why'd you choose this style, those shoes? Being with you feels high maintenance, she said. Felt like I needed to look the part. Ethic kept cutting. If I wanted that, I would choose that. I chose you. I want you. If you want the weave, I'm with it. If you want it, if you like it. I ain't the man to tell a woman how to be a woman, but be the type of woman you want to be, not the type you think I want, because all I want is you. She was silent for the next 30 minutes as he figured out how to remove all the muddy tracks from her hair. When all she had were cornrows left, she turned to him. This what you want? Nah, I can do without the Cleo joints, he said with a handsome smirk. Set it off. Okay, she had the straight back joints. Them prison braids. Listen. I'm hot. Oh my goodness. Okay. Alani splashed him as her laughter turned that smirk into a full-blown smile. She unraveled the braids and then he put his hands in her hair. Like this, he said, as he dug all in her scalp. I want you just like this. He washed the mud from her body and handled his business last before getting out. She stood in front of him, natural, short, shrunken curls, and all smiles. He wrapped her in a plush towel and then kissed her lips. Yo, we gotta put on some clothes before I lose my restraint, he said. Not a single word was a joke. He followed her into the bedroom. He appreciated the seclusion of this farmhouse. It protected their love, trapped their insecurities, and allowed them to flourish, allowed them to leave everything that hindered them back in the city, 4 hours away. He had envisioned a woman there when he had purchased it. He had pictured long nights filled with deep conversation on the porch swing. It sat on the edge of Lake Erie, miles and miles away from another soul. Hold on, y'all. I'm sorry. No one would ever find them if they didn't want them to. It was like their own world where they didn't have to apologize for working things out. They could love freely without judgment. Even the self-imposed conflict that he knew Alani suffered from. She never spoke of it, but he wasn't naive enough to think it had just dissipated. It existed. She was just polite enough to not vocalize it. The silk camisole and tiny silk boy shorts Alani put on was more enticing than bare skin. Are you hungry? She asked. Is there food here? I could eat, he answered. I had the kitchen stocked before we came up. I'll make something. She shook her head. Let me, she said. You can keep me company if you'd like. She tiptoed out of the room. He slid into boxer briefs and sweatpants before he followed the noise she was producing from his kitchen. He stood in the threshold, leaning against the wall, arms crossed, as he admired her. She had music playing from her cell phone that sat on the center island. One second, y'all. Sorry, y'all. I was trying to get some water in me. All right. Baby, it breaks my heart to think that loving me is not easy to do. You're into love songs, 90s music, he said, as he finessed his lips. Another nuance of dating, another lesson in all things Alani. He was learning her preferences, the simple ones. Mostly, she said, as she pulled eggs from the refrigerator. A lot of the songs are about heartbreak. I can relate, Ethic nodded. Now I'm in love with someone. Real love that I'd die before losing. The rest of the songs are about that. I can relate to that, too. Her words made him go warm inside. They were reassurance. He didn't know how she had become the person in his life that made things feel solid, but somehow, with just words, she comforted what had ailed him his entire life. As long as he had her, everything would be all right. She provided security in a different form than what most people valued, emotional equity. She supplied him with something money couldn't buy. Lucky man, she looked at him in the eyes. I should have been better to you, Ethic, before. I was so horrible to you. You should have walked out a long time ago, but you're here and you're loving me, even after I was so cruel. I can be mean. I've always been that way. It stops people from trying to get close and it stops me from letting them in because once people get in, once men get in, she paused and shook her head, closing her eyes. They hurt me. I'm sorry for being mean and hateful toward you. I'm not proud of that. She was taking accountability for the part she had played in their brokenness. Her eyes glistened with emotion because this was hard for her, admitting her wrongs. She wasn't a woman who did so easily, but everything she had done in relationships hadn't worked. This time around, she would do the opposite. What she had done before had made men leave, so this time she would move differently to get this man, this king, to stay. Don't apologize to me, Lanika. Don't apologize for your womanhood, the ups, the downs, the flux of emotions, the moods. You're a woman. That's what you're designed to do, to feel shit. You feel what you must, when you must. You weren't with men before. You chose boys. I'm a man. He paused and approached her, capturing her face in his hands. Even the feeling of his fingertips on her skin felt glorious. Her lids lowered as he commanded her stare. Alani couldn't breathe. He made her so nervous, filled her with such anxiety. He was so potent, so intoxicating. I'm your man, and I'll make you unfeel all that shit. She blushed and released all the tension she felt in a sigh. She was always so emotional with him. He made her bleed sentiment. He tasted her lips, a soft kiss, and she nestled her head right in his chest, wrapping her arms around his back. She loved their every interaction, but this one, a simple hug, would always be her favorite. His embrace was legendary, life-changing. In his arms, she felt safe. She heard the growl of his stomach, and she pulled back, reluctant to let him go, but comforted because she knew there were no more limits on his love. She could always go back for more. He had a need she could fill. He was starving. She would feed him. "I feel like eating breakfast. Is that cool?" "Whatever you want is fine," he said. "I know you're a healthy eater and all," she said. "Why wouldn't you tell me that? I know the first time I cooked for you, your stomach was tore up," she laughed, smiling wide, as the carefree look on her face moved epic on the inside. He shook his head, smiling. He couldn't remember the last time he had smiled so much. She had him out here like a lovesick teenager enjoying his first time with a girl on his arm. "Well, I like bacon. Real greasy, fat-covered bacon." She laughed at the grimace that spread across his face. "I'll make you a veggie omelet, baby." Baby. There she went with those damn arrows. He placed a hand over the left side of his chest, rubbing as he licked his lips. He could bypass the omelet in that moment. He had an appetite for something else. "That'll do," he replied. "You think we should call and check on the kids?" she asked. Damn, she had a whole arsenal of arrows. Where the fuck was she pulling them from? She was relentlessly aiming for his heart. Might as well call her Cupid. When Alani was happy, she radiated energy. She made his spirit glow. He told himself he had to keep her this way. He wrapped his arms around her waist. He held her from behind, burying his lips in the crook of her neck as she continued to dice onions and peppers. "They're fine. They know to call if they need me," he said. "Maybe we should have brought them," she countered. "I mean, this place just feels like a family is meant to fill these walls. It probably would have been good for Mo." Fuck. She was wetting shit up, spraying effortlessly. Arrows every fucking where. She had referred to the five of them as family, not friends, not kindred spirits, but a family, a singular unit that moved in conjunction with one another, that loved one another, fought for one another. She wanted to be a part of his clan. "I saw paddle boats out by the dock. They would have had so much fun." "How do you love them so much?" he asked. The question came out foreign, like he had put his words together incorrectly, but she knew exactly what he meant. How? Not why. How could Alani love his children so purely? He had to know. "They're important to me. When I couldn't have you, they gave me pieces of you. They restored my motherhood ethic. That Bella." She paused and shook her head as she smiled. "She loved me even when I didn't deserve it. She never thought twice, never hated me for hurting you," she whispered. "She's such a beautiful girl. Her energy." Alani felt a chill run down her spine and she shivered. Just the thought of Bella made her eyes mist. "You've really done a great job raising her alone." She moved on to rinsing the mushrooms, then put those under her blade as well. Ethic swayed her in his hold. Not far, just a slight rock back and forth while she diced. He listened to her praise his children. "And easy," she scoffed. "I've never had a boy. Boys and their mothers." She shook her head. "They say there is no deeper bond. If it's anything like the love he gives to me, I understand. When he barrels into me and wraps his arms around me, I just melt. He makes me feel needed." "You are needed, Lanika," he said. "Thank you for loving them the way you do. I never thought I'd trust a woman with them. Never thought I could trust anyone with them, in fact. Even when they're at school, it's this gnawing in my gut like I gotta stay ready to fuck shit up just in case someone hurts them. You've changed that. I've never felt like I had to protect them from you." She stretched her neck to look back at him, and he kissed her nose. "I know I'm not their mother, but I want to be something. I don't know where I fit, but I just want to fit," she admitted. She looked down in embarrassment because she knew she was moving too fast and revealing the hurt that still weighed on her. "Well, maybe I'm just desperate to be somebody's mother. I miss that part of my life." She pulled in a deep breath. "I'm sorry for bringing it up," she said as she exhaled and tried to shake away everything she was feeling. He turned her toward him. "You can bring it up. You can talk to me about that and anything else, even if it's hard, even if it's uncomfortable. I know what we have to work through. I know what goes through your head," he said, as he tapped her temple gently with two fingers. "Don't keep it there. Let it out as often as you need to. He gripped her face and she nodded, closing her eyes to seal the emotion that filled her eyes inside. I'm gonna go upstairs. I'm kind of tired. Is that okay? She whispered. Alani was barely keeping it together and she was desperate for a bit of privacy so she could gather herself. Ethic stepped back, giving her space. He lifted his hands in surrender and she bolted. She rushed for the stairs but halted at the edge of the kitchen. She gripped her stomach and folded her lips inside her mouth to stop the sob from fleeing. Ethic? Yeah. She couldn't turn to him because he would see her tears. He would see the guilt she felt for loving him. She sniffed. I'm not running away from you. I'm not leaving. I just need a minute, okay? He was silent as he watched her. Her neck bowed so disgracefully, despite the fact that she was the most graceful woman he had ever met. The sins in the room were his to bear, but just like a good woman, she was adopting them, finding fault in herself when it was he who had fucked up. He wanted to comfort her, but she needed space. It was so hard for Ethic to oblige because he just wanted her near. As much time as they had spent apart, he had anxiety whenever she disappeared for too long. He feared one day he would look away, and when he turned back to her, she would be gone. Like he was a dying man in a desert, and a mirage of her had given him reprieve, only to disappear before his very eyes. Okay, he said. Her feet on the wooden staircase sounded like a stampede as she raced up them. He dragged a slow hand over his face and sat. His eyes fell on her open tote bag, the one Bella had insisted on buying Alani last Christmas. Her manuscript sat inside. He hesitated before reaching for it, but curiosity urged him to pick up the pages. He was desperate to get inside her head because although she was keeping up a strong front, he knew she was broken inside. He could hear her stifling her cries upstairs. Going to her felt instinctual. Staying on the first level of the home felt respectful. The ethic of love. Something inside him splintered when he realized her book was about him. He flipped the page and began to read, bracing himself for what was to come. He captured my soul the first day he set eyes on me, and I haven't been free since. His touch sets me on fire. No matter if by hatred or love, I'm always set ablaze by him. It's the best and worst thing I've ever felt in my life. So explosive. I love him so much that even when I hate him, I still pray for him. The universe took my daughter and gave me him. Somehow, the transference of energy feels equal. There's no such thing as wrong love. I can finally admit to loving him. Every fiber of his being I adore, even the killer he keeps dormant inside, because he's motivated by love, never hate. I can survive with this sadness inside as long as he's next to me. I want to die without him because with him, life is dark. Without him, I'm blind. Some of the passages slid him right down the middle and left his insides at his feet on the floor. The book was heavy. It suffocated him slowly, and he understood now how she had developed the nerve to turn a gun on herself and pull the trigger. All of this had been inside her, festering, rotting her, depressing her. He sat there for hours, flipping through page after page until the words, "There is no end, not with us. There's only a new beginning. Every time we're even close to ending, I'll start over with him again, chasing a new outcome, a new destiny, because I'm a woman in love. I'll endure the pain forever before I ever allow this to end." And that's the end of that chapter. Well, if that's the case, then he could have beamed Messiah and then all his worries would have been over. Well, at least, because now that Bookie is dead, we just got Wolsey to deal with. And I'm sure if a woman is the one aiming a gun at him, he'll lay her ass down too. But, you know, hey. Child, listen. I am over it. Hey, Kay, happy Monday, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. And you'll hear this when you catch up to this point. All right. Let me get my timestamp for the next chapter, child. All right. Here we go, y'all. Chapter 16. Bella sat, watching Nanny sleep in her recliner as the news played on the TV screen. Easy's head rested in her lap, and she slid her thumb down the iPhone screen. Nighttime was noisy on the north side of Flint. It wasn't like in the suburbs. All she heard outside her window at home were crickets. At Nanny's, the streets came alive at night. All right, here we go. This about to be some bullshit. This little girl probably about to sneak outside and meet some little nappy-head boy. Lord have mercy. Hey, Shanae, happy Monday, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. The boisterous sounds of Connie and her friends playing cards right in the front yard echoed through the air. The smack of the basketball hitting the pavement was loud. The smell of barbecue permeated right through the front door. Bella lifted Easy's head and slowly inched from beneath him, taking extra caution not to wake him. She cringed as she took timid steps towards the front door. Every single floorboard seemed to creak along the way. She clenched her teeth as she pulled open the door and slid her body out. The cool air felt like freedom. She stuffed her hands into the pockets of her Gucci cardigan as she posted up on the bottom step. Ugh. Oh, this girl can't turn. I get a do-over. I can't jump right if the rope's sloppy. A group of girls stood in the middle of the street, barefoot on the dirty pavement, as a brown girl with long tribal braids stood on the curb with her hands on her hips. The street lights shone right over them, and the rope they turned ticked against the concrete in a cadence. Yes, they jump in double dutch, baby. That's what I'm talking about. Okay, I can dig it. I can dig it. Tribal girl jumped into the rope, and it tangled instantly. Get off the rope, Drea. You can't turn for me. The girl looked around, and her eyes fell on Bella. Yo, you know how to turn double dutch? Bella shrugged. Not really. I've never played, she admitted. Well, you got to be better than this girl. Come turn, the girl said. Unless you want to hug the porch all night. You Lanika's cousin or something? Bella stood and walked over to the game. She's my stepmom, Bella said without thinking twice. Since when she get married? My mama said her mean ass gonna be single forever, the girl said, laughing as the other girls chuckled too. She's not single. My daddy the one who bought her your mother's house, Bella said with a shrug and smirk. Okay, you got it, bougie ass, the girl said, turning up her nose. You turning a what? The girl snatched the ropes from another girl and handed them to Bella. Bella widened her stance and began to turn along with the girl standing across from her. Little Miss Tribal Braids jumped into the rope. What's your name anyway? The girl panted as she jumped. Bella. What kind of name is that? Oh, white girl name. You talk white too, dress all fancy. What school you go to? Grand Blanc. Bella answered. The girl did all types of tricks inside the ropes, and Connie came over to the curb. Hey, what y'all youngins know about double dutch? She challenged. She jumped into the rope, gut and butt bouncing everywhere as she took a turn with her daughter. Bella laughed as the adults in the yard cheered Connie on. When the ropes finally tangled, Connie waved them out the street. Come get y'all some food before it's all gone, she said. Bella turned back towards Nanny's house. You can come too, baby. Come get you a plate, Connie said. Aw, that was sweet. Aw. Bella stopped, glanced up at the house, wondering if she should just leave well enough alone and sneak back inside. Yo, Bougie, you coming? The girl asked. Bella backpedaled and then turned toward the loudmouthed girl to run and catch up. Nanny slept like a rock. As long as she was back before 5 o'clock in the morning when Nanny normally started her day, Bella would be fine. I'm Lyric, the girl said, as they stepped up to the table that was set up directly in front of the front steps to stop people from going into Connie's front door. The food was laid out in aluminum pans. That's Shayla and Bianca, she nodded to the other girls who were all grabbing paper plates. Hey, Bella greeted. That's all your hair? Bianca asked. Bella finessed her long ponytail. Yeah, it's mine, she answered. It's cute. Better braid that shit up out here. One fight and you getting dog walked with all that, Bianca added. One fight and my daddy shooting this whole block up, Bella shot back. Who you think your daddy is? You ain't even from around here, Shayla said. He probably some square. Nah, her daddy ain't no square. The voice came from behind them. Bella turned around frowning because someone was speaking on her father. Someone she was sure didn't know him at all. You ethic daughter, right? He the only nigga riding through the hood in a Tesla without getting pulled out that bitch. Niggas know better. That's your pops, right? Bella couldn't find her voice. The boy standing in front of her had peanut butter skin, fresh faded sides with a middle part and two braids to the back. She was stuck and staring. He smirked and licked his lips. She noticed the tiny scar above his top lip. It bubbled slightly and was barely noticeable, but was the cutest thing Bella had ever seen. Her heart fluttered. Y'all better be careful out here with her. One thing happened to her, and dear daddy hanging niggas from the streetlights, he said as he backpedaled. Ain't nothing gonna happen to her, boy. These hoes know not to start no shit over here. Everybody out here family, Lyric said. You good out here, girl. Don't listen to Hendrix. Hendrix. Bella was already practicing his name in bubble letters with glitter markers inside her mind. Y'all coming to the kickback? We about to break out, he said. Yeah, we coming around the back, though, because my mama gonna trip if she see us walk off with y'all, Lyric shot back. Bet, he said. Hendrix reached into Bella's plate and took a potato chip from it, stuffing it into his mouth before backpedaling back toward the group of boys that sat across the street posted on the porch. He's so fine, Shayla said, shaking her head. You coming, Bougie? Lyric asked. Yeah, I guess. That's cool, Bella said. She knew if she got caught, Epic would never let her out of his sight again, but no way was she not going. It was like the cute boy in the Jordan sweatsuit had cast a spell on her. Mom, we going to the store. We'll be back, Lyric called. Connie was busy on the card table and gave her permission with a wave of her hand. Come on, Lyric said, leading the way through the backyard. Bella looked back at Nanny's one time before slipping through the hole in the fence. How old are you, Bougie? Lyric asked. 13, she said. Her first lie, she was 12, but in her young mind, adding that 1 year made her seem more mature. You smoke? Bianca asked. Not with everybody, Bella answered. It was true. She had tried weed before once when Daphne Parker had brought some to school. They had snuck behind the bleachers to smoke. She had enjoyed the high, enjoyed forgetting about her worries of being a motherless child, of being the middle one. Mo got most of the attention because of her circumstances, and Easy was the youngest and Ethics prized gift from Raven. The weed had made her forget. But it had also stayed in her hair for hours. She'd had to wash it as soon as she got home, just so her dad never found out. Pause. It's just proof that three kids can grow up in the same house and each one of them has a different childhood with the same fucking actors. Perception is everything, y'all. We ain't everybody. We your people. You gonna need people if you gonna be coming around the way, rocking Gucci without getting that shit snatched, Lyric said. I'm not really worried about that, Bella said. You think your daddy big shit, huh, Bougie? Lyric asked with a chuckle. Bella shrugged. She didn't think that. She knew that. She was realizing how much weight her father's name carried, how much respect he received, and she knew why. Because he's a killer. The thought used to scare her. It no longer did. She didn't like it, but after what Queen had done to Alani, Bella understood that sometimes there were consequences to actions. When dealing with her father, those consequences were severe. She had lost a sibling, and she had a feeling that Queen had lost his life behind that. She felt no qualms about it. Okay, Lyric joked. They approached an abandoned house, and Bella heard the sounds of music coming from behind the tan boards covering the doors and windows. Lyric pulled back the board to the front door, slid inside. Bella frowned as she stepped inside. Graffiti covered the walls, trash littered the floor, but it was packed. Weed smoke and the sound of Big Sean filled the air. Lord, there's an omen right there. Candles lit the space. You guys hang out here? Bella asked. Yeah, nobody bothers us. We can swerve without my mama nosy ass hating, Lyric said. Swerve? Bella frowned in confusion. Smoke, drink, just do whatever we want. No eyes on us, just complete freedom. Bella got that part, the freedom part. Being Ethics' child had a way of feeling like being imprisoned. He was so afraid of losing, so concerned with death that he smothered them a bit. It was why she enjoyed coming to Nanny's. It was emancipation. Bella could travel the blocks out of her sight as long as the streetlights didn't beat her home. Nanny had grown up in the hood, so there wasn't much that scared her. She knew everyone on the block. Bella was free to roam, but never after dark, never this late. She checked her phone, discovering that it was nearing midnight. She knew Nanny was still sleeping because had she discovered Bella's absence, her phone would have been blowing up by now. You want something to drink? Lyric asked. Bella shook her head. Her heart was pounding. Anxiety crawled through her bones as she took in the faces in the darkened room. Teenagers of all ages parlaying, chilling, playing grown, when really they didn't even know what being grown entailed. It was an entirely different world than the one Ethic had raised her in. She was a lion cub that had made her way to the wild. She would either thrive and build a kingdom or die. There was no in between. Lyric and the girls sparked up causing Bella to fan the smoke away from her. No way would she be able to walk back into Nanny's house smelling like kush. I'm gonna get some air, she said. Lyric nodded as she pinched the joint between her lips and inhaled until the tip turned orange. Bella turned sideways, easing through the thickening crowd, and then pushed the cardboard aisle to exit. Running back to the burbs already? The question was awaiting her as soon as she touched the first step. She turned to find Hendrix sitting off to the side of the porch alone. "I'm not running," she answered back. He scoffed and leaned forward to his knees. "How old are you anyway?" he asked. 14, she lied. "How old are you really?" he said with a lazy smile. "I'll be 13 in 3 months," she whispered. For some reason, it sounded better than 12. 12 sounded childish. "How old are you?" "Years don't matter with somebody like me. With the stuff I've seen, I might as well be an old man out here," Hendrix said. "Well, if that's the way you're counting, I'm old out here too," she mumbled. Bella shrank under his scrutiny as he took her in. "It's rude to stare," she said, lifting her eyes to stare right back. "Stop doing it then, nigga," Hendrix shot back. She bit into her bottom lip and looked toward the street to stop him from seeing through her. She liked him. She had a feeling that he knew that she liked him. She had a feeling that a lot of girls liked him and that he didn't like very many back. Her stomach hollowed and the palms of her hands dewed. Bella could barely breathe. She was so nervous. "A girl like you ain't even supposed to be out here," he stated. "Like me?" she asked. She wondered what he saw when he looked at her. What did that mean? What type of girl was she? Was it the type he liked? "Yeah," he said. "Good. Nobody around here has that. Ain't none of us out here innocent. We're all wolves, even Lyric and them. We're all bad. It's just in us. We the bottom. We so low they trying to poison us out. We ain't worth nothing. Ain't got nothing. Not even clean water to drink. You don't belong here. You come here because you think it's fun. This partying and bullshitting seem fun. And it is when you're not from around here. But for us, it's the only way to escape. For all of us, this is a trap." Bella didn't know how to respond. She couldn't pretend to know what it felt like to be in his shoes. She had always had the best of everything. She had never worked for anything a day of her life. She certainly didn't know deprivation, but she knew loss. She was a girl who had gone without a mother for the majority of her life. Alani made it easier. Alani was changing that, but she would never forget the years she had gone feeling like a motherless child. Those years had hurt. She had been trapped, not by poverty, but by abandonment. She was trapped by the secret resentment she held against a dead woman. Bella hated her mother for not being strong enough to escape the man that had killed her. She had never been brave enough to admit that to anyone. Then, out of nowhere, Alani had come along and loved that resentment away. She had shown Bella a love that she was missing, filled the most painful void as if it had never been there at all. "Maybe you just need someone to show you a way out," Bella said. He stood from his seat and approached her. He towered over Bella's small frame, long and lanky, with tattoos and barely there facial hair. She tried to guess his age. She wasn't sure why she was holding her breath. He made her feel like she would pass out, like she was dizzy, and if she tried to walk away, she would embarrass herself and fall. Her throat tightened in anxiety and her mouth dried. She had liked a boy before, but it had felt nothing like this. A car pulled up to the curb and a boy wearing a red bandana around his head hung halfway out the window. "Yo, Dree. Nigga, what up?" Hendrix looked down at Bella and then rolled eyes out to the car full of young men. "Can't show me the way out if you're here too," he said. "Go home before your pops come through and shut the whole block down," he said, then bumped her slightly as he slid by her. He was rude, arrogant, and he took those steps in such a cool swagger that Bella couldn't tear her eyes away. When he bent over to climb into the car, his hoodie lifted slightly, revealing the handle of a chrome pistol. Bella's heart quickened. Bad boys just did something to good girls. It was the way of the hood. It never failed. She turned to go back inside, but before she could even lift the cardboard covering the door, she heard, "Yo, pretty girl." She turned to see his face come into view as the back window rolled down. "Home is that way," he stated, pointing down the block. "Go home." The car pulled away, and for some reason, Bella listened. She tucked her hands in her back pockets and descended the steps, heading back to Nanny's with thoughts of Hendrix running through her mind. And that's the end of that chapter. So this nigga mad at her because her daddy is who he is and she is a child of a man of means. And so he gonna treat her like that and bump her and shit. Nigga, blame your mama now. Don't blame her. The fuck? I mean, I get what he's saying, but still, like, nigga, that's how I keep telling y'all, these niggas don't like black women. It don't matter how young or old. They hateful. Fucking bastard. Anyway. All right, where we at, y'all? Let me see. I don't know where I'm at. Oh, yeah, gut and butt in the double dutch rope. Child, listen. My goodness, gut and butt be jumping when you jump a double dust, child. All that shit be jiggling. Okay, I spoke to Nordic. Yes, I did. No, hell no to the kickback, right? She should have took her ass back inside her nanny's house. And listen, I'm gonna tell Ethic. Next time, Nanny should come to Ethic's house, not this shit. So Nordic said, you was a young girl before going to the kickbacks, my child. Listen, I used to be in parties at Mendel when I had no business there and sneaking into the copper box with a fake ass ID. Child, listen, don't nobody know nothing about it. Right. Fooling around and hanging out with girls from Julian and Carver and CVS. Listen. I wonder what them hoes at today. Child, listen. 15, actually, I had older sisters. Okay. Child, listen, we ain't had no business being out there. Well, I should say I did. I didn't have any business being out there. So Nordic said, I was perceived as the black sheep. I am the protection, the enforcer. Okay, all right, I got you. I got you. Hey, Kim Burr. Hey, Love Muffin. Happy Juneteenth, boo. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. All right, let me see. Yes, take your little ass home, Bella. Absolutely. Go the fuck home, child. Listen. All right, so let me get my time stamp for this next chapter, child. I wish people would stop playing with my stuff here. Hold on, y'all. I gotta tell y'all this damn all right, YouTube be like so many people, like so three people now just sent me DMs asking me, did I kick them off my channel? No, I didn't. YouTube, y'all, periodically unsubscribes people from channels. I don't know why the fuck they do that. It's so fucking stupid. Y'all, please always check and make sure you're still subscribed to the channel, baby. I can't unsubscribe you from my channel. I don't have the power to do that. I mean, I can block people, but I don't block nobody. The people that I've blocked are people that are blocked for a reason. But I don't just, block people. Anybody is welcome in my chat, and if you block, you'll find out when you try to type in there. But I don't give a damn about who come over here. I really don't. Anybody's welcome in the speakeasy unless you block. If you blocked, you blocked for life. Okay, I forgive you, but fuck you. How about that? So, but other than that, I mean, I don't block people, but YouTube would it just randomly unsubscribes people. It happened to me. Child, I moderate for several people on YouTube. And do you know the other day I found out I was unsubscribed from two of the people that I moderate for? We can't unsubscribe anybody as content creators. YouTube just does it on its own. I mean, I don't even, it's like I get that y how y'all would think that because y'all aren't content creators and you don't know. All we can ever do as a content creator is block your ass. We can't unsubscribe you from our channel. People are blocked and still subscribed. Yeah, it happens. Blocking somebody doesn't unsubscribe them from the channel. It just stops them from chatting in the chat box. So yeah, YouTube be on bullshit all the time, Nordic. They do it all the time. You'll go to bed with one number, child, and wake up and be done. It'd be five people be done unsubbed. And then at first I was thinking like, why people unsubbing? But it wasn't them. Because then a couple days later, it would be right back. YouTube, they be on that bullshit, child. Listen. Yes. I started that shit. Nobody was saying block party on YouTube. I was a moderator for Nosy on her old channel. And I was like, these mother, I'm sending their asses to the block party. And I was like, we serving drinks over there. Enjoy the block party, ho. Oh shit. And now everybody all over, oh, the block party. I'm telling you can't have shit. It's a whole lot of shit that I was the first person to say on YouTube and other people just claimed it. And I let them, child, because listen, I'm creative.
You don't even feel no type of way when you know you creative and can come up with new shit at the drop of a hat. I don't give a fuck. Have at it, child, because that's probably the only thing your punk ass got. So I'm going to let you have it, child. But yes, I used to send motherfuckers to the block party. I was like, yes, God. Child, fuck what you heard. Absolutely. Trailblazer, trendsetter. Absolutely. Plenty of shit I did before. And now motherfuckers acting like they was the first. Girl, fuck out of here. All right, so let me, I don't know why black women do each other like that. It's so fucking stupid, but maybe next lifetime when I come back, these hoes will have their shit together. Other than that, y'all, I don't know what to say. All right, let me keep going, because y'all didn't come over here to hear about that shit today. That's for Friday or some other day. Chapter 17. Ethic's heart raged like a river flowing downstream. His emotions flooded everything as he made his way up the stairs. He was sure she was asleep by now. The sun would be rising soon. It had taken him all night to read her work. Some pages he'd read twice to fully absorb the impact of her words. It was a story about the fairness of love. But were there rules to it? Had they broken them? He wasn't sure, but he knew one thing. He had shattered her. He entered the bedroom, and the silhouette of her frame could be seen beneath the sheets. She laid on her side with her back to him, and he eased into the bed. He wrapped one arm around her and she stirred as she pulled his hand close to her chest, intertwining her fingers with his, then making a combined fist. He kissed the back of her neck. Ethic? Her voice was as clear as day. She hadn't slept. She had been lying there for hours overthinking. He huffed. I can't sleep. My mind is racing. There's this hole that I feel sometimes right in the center of me. I need you to feel me, because right now I'm so empty, she whispered. I need to feel you. He thought of Morgan in that moment. She had talked about feeling holes inside too, and he wondered if every man that had ever hurt a woman, intentional or not, dug a new one. How could women walk around so strong if they were hollow on the inside? It nagged at his gut. I need you inside me, Alani whispered. But Nair, fuck Nair, Alani shot back. I need it. You need it, baby, he whispered, pressing into her, growing at the thought as he hardened against her softness. Yes, she panted. He gripped the base of his knee and rubbed the tip against her behind. Expert hands peeled down those shorts and he planted a kiss on her shoulder. She felt his warmth against her as his strength split her southern lips. He gripped her left breast as his dick entered wet walls. His lips to the back of her neck accompanied the thrust that divided her. He fucked her on her side, so thick, so long that he touched her depths. Even in this loving position, she turned her neck to see him, gripping the back of his head as she struggled to kiss his lips. God, she just wanted to taste him. It wasn't in the way he fucked her. It was in the way he held her, gripping her flesh to flesh with desperation, as if he was afraid to let go. He groaned. I missed you, baby, he whispered. His fist, balled in hers, was over her heart as he thrust in and out. She felt every muscle in his body flexing, working to bring her pleasure. The subtle moans he tried to stifle lived in her ear as he repositioned himself, turning her on her stomach as he stroked from behind. The way he licked her back while stroking her slow had Alani climbing the walls, whining so softly that it sounded like she was crying. There was no pain in this room, however. This was all pleasure. This was well-earned and long overdue. The mental and spiritual awakening happening in her, and more importantly, in him, would lead them to orgasm. His strong thighs were spread so wide, giving him leverage as he dug for her treasure. His stroke was so passionate, so slow, with a little bit of thug at the very end of each pump when he popped the back of her pussy with aggression. Ethic was taking her body for a ride, and all she could do was hold on tight. I'm about to come. Ezra, she screamed. She panicked when she felt him stop moving. It was like someone had tossed her into the deep end of a pool. No, no, Ethic, please. God, keep going. There was no doubt about it. She was begging for this dick. He was stroking her balls deep, making her take it all before pulling out to the tip and then diving in again. I just want to take my time with you, baby, Ethic whispered, going still. Because if he kept at this pace,
he was going to explode. He wanted to relish in this. He wanted to take his time with this plate, savor the taste, eat it in courses, then beat so good he put her to sleep. Be patient with me. The words that fell from this man's tongue, patience was a virtue, one that Alani didn't possess. They had been apart for almost a year, and they had so much love making to catch up on. Ethic was the type of man you made love to every night. They had missed too many nights, and Alani wanted to play catch up. She had been lonely, full of hurt and burden for so long. She had been ashamed to love him, but in this bedroom, under the roof that he provided, the roof that he wanted her to live under with him, she finally felt peace. She felt him. Ethic had a way of turning night to morning. As he made magic of her body, she just held on tight. He brought her to tears. It felt so fucking good. God, he was amazing. How the hell was he this amazing? A fucking marvel of a man designed to bring her to orgasm. Alani was thirsty from exhaustion as she tried to keep up. Her throat dried and her moans ran out of her raspy as she threw her sex back at him while he took her from behind. Alani couldn't keep up. He popped that thing like his life depended on it, like her love depended on it. Like if he didn't make her feel that ache in the back of her depths when a nigga went a little too hard, she would leave him. Ethic had her spinning. Alani wasn't sure what was up or down as he dug into the meat of the back of her thighs with his fingertips. He was the best sex she had ever had, and each time it got better, like he trained for this shit, like he went home and played back the game tapes to make sure he had made the three-point shot next time. What the fuck, she thought. Alani knew she was ugly. The way her face twisted up from absolute pleasure, she couldn't worry about looking sexy. She was just trying to take it, gritting her teeth and biting her tongue to handle it. What the entire fuck, she thought. Alani would kill him, shoot him dead, and not miss this time if he ever, motherfucking ever, even thought about giving this dick to anyone else. It was hers. She was staying. Fuck everybody who thought otherwise, and fuck Nair's holy ass too for trying to keep her from this pleasure. They could start their own religion because this man was a god. Ethic made her delirious. She couldn't think straight when he was inside her. It was a crazy she welcomed, a delusion she enjoyed. This black, burnt, yoga practicing, patient having, perfect father being, pussy slaying ass nigga was fucking the shit out of Alani, and she was sold. She was his. She didn't care how many tears she had to cry in the bathroom behind closed doors. She would never leave dick like this. She had paid for it in pain, and the receipt of her heart said non-refundable. The grumble in the back of his throat every time he connected with the back of her let her know he was close. It let her know she was the shit. Ethic, wait, she moaned. Please, he slowed. What are you doing? I'll kill you if you stop, she threatened as her arms spread wide at her sides, her nails clutching the sheets. Patience, he groaned. Slap. A right ass cheek stung as he shortened his stroke. Alani whimpered like she was injured, and she was. He was beating that thing. Beating it like a drum, beating it like he was dressed in African cloth and there were barefoot dancers in the room. My fucking God! Alani came hard, harder than she ever had before. She had lost the fight. She let the folds of her flesh pulse. Yep, he had beat that shit all the way up. It was throbbing. She felt wetness gush from her all over him. Damn, he whispered as he gripped both of her cheeks and massaged them in a circle, making them go round and round on his dick because he was still inside her. And the visual of her ass with the slightly lighter stretch marks moving over the black rod that parted her. God damn, this nigga here, even the sound of his voice made her swoon. He pulled out and she felt hollow. Do a bitch got any walls left? She thought. He came up her body, hovering over her. As she lay there on her stomach, he kissed the back of her neck. She moaned. I'm sorry, he whispered, for everything you felt besides this, for everything I've given you that wasn't love. This nigga here, she thought. Ethic was a whole man. Most had a way with words. Some paid bills well. Some laid the pipe. Others, you felt protected around. Some men made you laugh. Ethic did it all. He had a way with everything. He left no opportunity for another man to make her feel something that he didn't provide. He gave her his all. Where did he even come from? Where did they make his particular model this type? Could bitches order one up on Amazon? Because Amazon had every fucking thing. She would Amazon Prime the fuck out of this nigga if she could. Nah. It didn't have nothing like this. He was out of stock, one of one, a rare collector's edition, and he was hers. Alani turned to him, fighting her fatigue as he went onto his back. Alani mounted him. He was much like that Mustang. She was afraid to saddle him, fearful that she couldn't tame his wild, that he would buck her off, but she was a glutton for punishment. She slid down onto him. He was like the stake you stuck into the ground when you pitched a tent to keep it grounded. He rooted her. He kept her from blowing away in the wind. Alani leaned down and kissed him. Sloppy kisses, desperate kisses, let me swallow your black ass whole type of kisses. She moved her hips slowly, adjusting to his width because he filled her every inch. Thick ass, long ass. Ethic's dick was perfection, and she rode that thing up, down, circles, bounce a little. He reached up and placed his hands on her breasts and then brought her down so that he could taste them, kissing one, then the other, biting one, then the other, flicking one, then the other, pushing them together and then sucking both. This nigga here, she thought. He lifted his pelvis to meet her halfway because she was Ethics woman, and Ethics woman simply didn't do all the work by herself. Never would he ever let that happen. Alani might as well have been skating like an old school 90s rink, gliding from side to side on that thing because they had found a rhythm. Ethic, I can't take it, she groaned as she closed her eyes and laid against his chest. And she came again, before him. Again, the stamina of this man was incredible. Two for one, baby, he whispered as he wrapped both arms around her back and then kissed her shoulder. She cried, like real tears, like sobbed and not in pain. It was just too much pleasure. Everybody knew too much chocolate made your tummy ache, but just like a fat kid with cake, Alani wanted more. He was still inside her. She was leaking all over him. Round three. Alani Hill in one corner, black eyes, busted lip, clinging to the ropes. She could barely stand. Ethic Okafor in the other, bobbing and weaving as he threw practice jabs in her direction, unaffected. The motherfucking people's champ. Nah, scratch that. The motherfucking pussy champ. Fuck it. She was going back into the ring. He would have to knock her out to get the title because there was not an ounce of bitch in her. She wouldn't quit. Even if she was losing, she would get in this ring with him again and again, go round for round. Nothing less than the knockout would take her down. Alani only knew one advantage she had over him, and as she lifted, she felt flutters of confidence flutter in her stomach. She lowered her head into his lap, and she felt him tense. As one hand gripped the top of her head, Alani took him into her mouth without reserve, like the juices covering him was topping of a froyo cone because she was trying to lose a couple pounds, so ice cream was a no-go. The way he slid to the back of her throat and gripped her desperately, tensing beneath her toes, cracking as they curled, made Alani go harder. Her hands were cold, so she placed them under his ass, warming them while forcing him deeper down her throat. Fuck! She knew she was doing her job because Ethic wasn't very vocal during sex, unless he couldn't help it. When her hands lost their chill, she wrapped them around him, rotated like she was grinding pepper. She slobbered all over him, focusing on the light-skinned part of his wide head. She tugged up, then down, while her wrists went to work. Fuck! Checkmate, nigga. She felt his orgasm as it rose from the base of him and pulsed all the way to the top. Alani had developed a taste for him the very first time she had wrapped her lips around him. She didn't pull back. She swallowed him, not daring to waste a drop, like his nut was made of truffles, because everybody knew you didn't waste that expensive shit. Fuck, he reacted. She had stolen the rest of his vocabulary. She climbed him, laying directly on top of him, as he wrapped her in a cocoon of security, his arms covered like a blanket. A kiss to the top of her head. We don't have to tell Naya. We'll just start over in the morning. A do-over. We just needed to get it out of our systems one last time, she whispered. Yup, he groaned. Start fresh in the morning. He agreed in a sleepy drawl. They both desperately wanted to get this counseling thing right, but damn, it was hard to stay disconnected from one another. Sexually was where they performed best. She felt the soothing stroke of his hand against her back, and her eyes closed, knocked out. The bout was over, and just like that, the emptiness she felt was filled. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, Lord have mercy. All right. Ciao. Yeah, that's the end of that chapter, y'all. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Nordic. Oh, I appreciate that. Thank you, Kim Cash. Y'all too kind. Too kind. And thank you for that as well, Nordic. All right, let me get this next chapter, child, because after this next one, we only got four left. And there's only 44 minutes left in the book. These about to be quick. I hope he never say that. You heard me? Because sometimes you don't want to take the shortcut. You my God. Y'all listen, every once in a while you want an appetizer, but I'll take the full course meal, please, and thank you. Shit. No, you lying. Chapter 18. Alani groaned as she lifted her head slightly. She was stuck to Ethic. Neither had moved in hours, and she had to peel her skin from his as she awoke from the slumber. The taste of dick was on her breath and a little bit of pussy. She gagged as she climbed from the bed, hearing Nanny's voice in her head. Don't think I don't know you out here hunching. Come in here with Dussie all over your breath. Not Dussie. Dick and pussy. Lord have mercy. Listen, Linda. Alani had to stifle a laugh because she had never known what Nanny meant until this very moment. She definitely reeked of both, and she tiptoed to the bathroom, taking extra care not to wake him. The shower felt amazing as the water pressure rained down over her. She wished she'd brought hair products. Now that the weave was out, her wash and go would be unruly because she had nothing to define her curls, not even a ponytail holder to tie her hair back. She let the night's sins go down the drain before stepping out. She brushed her teeth and then slipped into leggings and a tank before creeping out of the room. It felt glorious to leave him there sleeping, resting, because she knew all she had to do was turn right back to be underneath him. They had never had that, the promise of tomorrow. They always loved one another in doses, taking in as much of each other in one night because when the sun rose, it shined down on their shame, causing them to flee. This time was different. This time she could stay and it felt glorious. She grabbed the keys to Ethic's car and walked out to grab her yoga mat. She turned to head back to the house when the sound of the waves washing gently ashore garnered her attention. The farm was truly peace on earth. She didn't even know how Ethic had found it. She had never thought about the northern, more secluded parts of Michigan. All she had known was the hood. This part of the state was beautiful, and she wouldn't mind staying forever with him. The seclusion would feel like a gift. Child, I hope she don't find out she done read his book. And then she go to acting a fucking fool again. Because I can't take it with this bitch. She be irking my nerves, man. She like a corn on your pinky toe when you're trying to wear some fucking heels or something. Or what I would imagine that would feel like. Because I don't fuck with heels. Well, not on the floor anyway. Heels ain't never been on the floor. You heard me? Watch out that time. You know then, you know. Anyway, child, so as I was saying, she get on my fucking nerves. You know, she's annoying. All right. She made her way to the edge of the water and spread the mat out. The sun beamed over her as the sound of crickets sounded in the distance. Such natural peace, She would burn up out here under the sun, but it somehow felt like the perfect place to meditate. She slipped out of her flip-flops, kicked off her yoga pants, and shed her top. She tested the water's temperature. It was brisk. She didn't dare dip anything other than a toe inside. The water gave its own soundtrack as she began her daily routine. She felt free as the air kissed her skin. She felt uninhibited, like the struggle that had weighed her down was finally lifting, or she was just getting stronger, strong enough to beat whatever devils were attacking her spirit. She was proud of the woman she was becoming. It was a slow transformation, but she was no longer discounting the strides she made. All movement was good, as long as it was forward. It was progress, and she was proud of that. She planted her palms into the mat as she kept her pelvis to the ground and lifted up onto her straight arms. Vinyasa, she thought, as she centered her breathing. In through her nose, deep breathing. Hold. Hold some more. Control it. Feel it. Out through her mouth. She was breathing. She was living. I'm fine. He's fine. We're okay. She moved up into a downward dog before bringing her right knee to her left elbow, feeling the strength of her abs as her body shook from the pressure it took to maintain that form. Feel the struggle. Feel the hard moments, the burn. It hurts to hold this position too long. I'm not strong here. Fight for it anyway. Fight for him. She lifted her right leg behind her before lowering to the ground. Vinyasa. Down, dog. She could feel the tension leaving her as she sucked in air through her nose and blew out hard through her mouth, expelling energy, throwing away bullshit, blocking the fuck shit. Her eyes were closed. She could feel the eradication. She was discharging negativity, centering, feeling nothingness. Then she felt him. She felt him before he ever touched her. Ethic was an energy, a strike of lightning that set her body ablaze whenever he was around. She groaned when she felt the hardness nestle right in the center of her behind. The cool air kissed her clit as he slid her panties to the side. She wasn't cold long. His warm length parted her from behind. He didn't ask because he didn't need to. Her body was his to partake in whenever he pleased. I tried, baby, he whispered. Alani grit her teeth, sucking in air through parted lips as her forehead wrinkled in satisfaction. Those eyes squeezed tighter. This feeling was delicious. It was edible. No, she whispered, whining. We're connecting in other ways. We're supposed to be abstaining, Ethic. Last night was supposed to get it out of our systems. Her words came out an octave higher. He tensed into her again, stroking her deeper, and her mouth fell open in bliss. He was so thick and long. He split her open so right that she felt like calling his name. You can't put this in front of me like this and expect me not to do something with it. His drawl was full of wanting. You're all through my system, baby. Can't get rid of this shit. He palmed a mound of her flesh before applying the sting of a smack. He picked up his pace. He spread her open wider every time he went deep. It was the sweetest thing she had ever felt. Ah, she cried. Her arms were at her side, lying flat against the mat, and Ethic grabbed them, pulling on them, using them as reins to pull her back onto his dick. She knew now why he brought her here. No one was around to hear her screams. This was an abduction. He had kidnapped her heart and was going to torture her in the sweetest way all weekend. His captor, he tensed into her so deeply that her stomach was flat on the ground. She was just lying there, whimpering in absolute bliss as he had his way with her. In the middle of the day, her passionate pleas echoing into the air while her tears fell from her eyes. He loved her so much. She loved him even more. She was spent. Her body was sore, pussy throbbing, but she didn't want him to stop. Couldn't bear it if he stopped. She wanted to see him, and just like Ethic, to sense the need he pulled out. Come, he whispered. She turned and crawled into his lap, fitting onto his dick like she was the puzzle piece he connected to. He gripped her curls and held her in place as she rode him gently while staring into his eyes. I want a life with you, Alani, he whispered. I want to put life in you. A streak of fear blazed through her. He was talking about a baby, a permanent link. There was still so much pain from the one she had lost, the one they had lost. He didn't know her history. He didn't know that their body or sorry, her body wouldn't cooperate. If he wanted a baby with her, if he wanted to make another baby and she couldn't give him one, the thought terrified her. Both the thought of birthing another and of not being able to scared her. It was rock and hard thing predicament. She was in one of those, and she wondered if she should tell him. Would he still want her? She was tainted fruit. He felt her shift of energy, and he pulled back, gripping her face with one hand, staring into her eyes curiously as he kept guiding her down with the other. She blinked away the trepidation, hiding it behind lust before he detected it. Delicate fingers graced his face as she gave him soft kisses while riding him. She made him feel like a king. He reminded her that she was a queen. This was perfection, or as close to it as two lovers could get. Alani wrapped her arms around his neck as her mouth parted. I'm coming, Ethic. She barely said it. It was a gasp on the tip of her tongue. She couldn't catch her breath. He leaned over her, putting her on her back as he raced her to the finish line, causing her to tremor. This shit is amazing, he growled as he buried his face in the nick of her neck. He pulled back, grabbing her feet as his head fell back and he bit his lip, joining her there at their favorite place. He stood and reached down for her. She took his hand and he pulled her to her feet before scooping her into his arms and then heading for the water. You bet not, she warned as she held on tight. Ethic, I swear to God, if you drop me in this water. It was all she got out before he tossed her, then dove in himself. The shock of the cold was exhilarating. She popped up, swept the water from her vision. I'm gonna kill you, boy. He smiled, a broad smile, a content smile. It was one she had never seen before and she loved. I'm sorry, y'all. She loved it as he swam to her. When he smiled like that, she heard birds chirping like she was a real-life princess who had been saved by a prince. But no, this wasn't that story. This was real. She was a black woman who had been saved by Ezra Ethic Okafor. And it was better than any fairy tale she had heard as a little girl. This man had loved her back to life, killed her with a complicated truth, then revived her again. They weren't perfect, but love wasn't supposed to be. It was supposed to be resilient. It was supposed to be strong. And everything about the two of them was exactly that. She wrapped her legs around his waist as he stood in front of her. Then he took her deeper, further into the depths of the lake, and his heart always submerging her. I read your book, he admitted. She tensed. Some of that I wrote before we fixed things. It's not what I feel now. It's good, he said. Really? She answered in surprise. She thought he would be offended or angry or hurt. His understanding was shocking. Her eyes burned with emotion. The day she had spent writing those passages were dark. She had been drowned in hatred and grief. She had wanted to cut it out, to just bleed it out. Her ink was the blood, and it had spilled freely until it had killed the grief, murdered the depression. And it was all about him, all about what they had been through, and he liked it. How could he like it? How could he be so supportive that he was able to read the pain he had caused without taking offense? Ethic was built different than any man she had ever encountered, and there was a pang of regret in her stomach for making him feel all of those dark days, because he was truly spectacular, a one in a million type of man, type of love. God made no mistakes when he crafted him. He was carving out perfection when he made Ethic. Very, he added. My professor wants to represent me. He has friends in the publishing industry. He gave it to a friend to read, and they want to publish it, she said. He emailed me a week ago about it, and I haven't answered. You should, Ethic whispered as he carried her back to the shore. It's our story, though. It's mine and yours. Those characters are me and you. It feels too personal to share, she admitted. It feels like people will judge. Fuck people, he stated. Do what you feel. She didn't unwrap her legs when they emerged from the water, and Ethic took wide steps toward the house. You gonna make a nigga carry you the whole way? She hung on tight and nodded. Yup, that's the only way I'll make it. He smiled, a stubborn half smile, and kissed her neck as he carried her back toward the house. He would carry her. He would shoulder the weight, every burden, all insecurities, always. You gonna call me, even though you hit twice on the first date? She asked. Amusement dancing in her eyes. As good as that shit is, I'm pulling up on you. Fuck a phone call. Alani hollered in laughter and buried her face into his chest, embarrassed, as he carried her into the house. His heart was full, and he hated to admit it, but she was right about the dating thing. It was good for them. It was a piece of their relationship that he hadn't realized was missing. He would be patient with her and jump through all these remedial hoops one at a time, as long as she needed him to. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Marva said I had my eyes closed during that last scene. Lord have mercy, child. Listen. A mess. Y'all are a mess. Okay, let me get this next time stand together. Oh, Lord. I keep trying to catch it. There we go. Chapter 19. Baby. You don't know what you do to me. Between me and you, I feel a chemistry. Morgan stood in front of the mirror in the rec center and her body was going through the movements, but her mind was a million miles away. Aaliyah oozed through the speakers and Mo felt tears burning her eyes. Aria danced beside her, but Mo wasn't feeling it. She couldn't feel anything but hurt and she froze mid-routine, turning away from the mirror as she doubled over in grief. Aria stopped the song and panted out of breath as she looked at Mo in sympathy. Aw, Mo, she whispered. I can't do this, Aria. I can't, Mo gasped. Morgan sat right where she stood, in the middle of the wooden dance floor. She pulled her knees to her chest and buried her head on top of them, weeping. Aria sat beside her, rubbing small circles against her back. Mo, what can I do? She asked. I need ethics, she whispered. Call him. Please. Morgan was falling apart. She had done that a lot over the years, and every time he had put her back together, he knew how to do it effortlessly. He had memorized where her pieces fit, and she needed him to come put them back in place again because Messiah had destroyed her puzzle. Ethic. I need ethic. She cried it from her soul, panicking, unable to breathe, unable to even see as the tears blurred her vision. Anxiety attacks, depression, the dark thoughts that had scared her as a child. It hadn't plagued her in so long that she had thought it to be just a phase that she worked through after losing her sister. But Messiah's lies, Messiah's deceit was bringing it all back. Okay, okay. Aria said, rushing to Morgan's bag and returning with her phone. Morgan grabbed it and unlocked the screen, but her finger lingered over Ethic's name as a beat of hesitation seized her. For so long, they had lived in a state of pain with one another over Raven's death. They were the only two that felt it at such powerful magnitude. He understood. Her pain was his. They had shared the devastation for years, and Morgan loved him for feeling it so deeply with her. She loved Ethic with her soul. He was her sister's love. From the first time Morgan had set eyes on Ethic, she had loved him. She wanted a man just like him because she had watched him love over the years, and no one loved a woman better than Ethic. Messiah was supposed to be that for her. He was supposed to be like her father. He was taught by the very man who had shown her what love looked like. How had he failed so miserably? Morgan wanted to call him so bad, both of them, Ethic and Messiah, but she didn't. Ethic no longer lived in the shadows. He was no longer grieving in the dark. Alani had pulled him to the light. Ethic was off somewhere loving and living. He was moving on, and Morgan thought she was too, but Morgan would forever be cloaked in despair. The one shot she had taken at reviving her heart had backfired. She ended up in the bed of her enemy, in the crosshairs of Mizan's brother. Morgan just wanted it all to go away. It was eating away at her. Mo, do you want me to call him for you? Aria asked, kneeling and looking at Morgan in concern. Morgan stood abruptly to her feet. No, I just need to get out of here. Fuck this. Fuck all this shit, she said, rushing to grab her bag. Mo, Aria shouted. Morgan turned. Just as she got to the door, she shook her head as tears streamed down her face. You make sure Messiah knows that everything is all fucked up because of him, that this is all his fault. And that's the end of that chapter. This girl is poor baby.
Child, listen, Linda, I don't even know what to say. I mean, I know what to say because she's just so annoyingly annoying. Poor little tank tank. I hope y'all are all having a good day. I didn't even realize that I hadn't asked if y'all were having a great day. I'm up here reading to y'all, and normally on this day I would be somewhere in tears, but I'm so goddamn nosy that yeah. So I'm up here with y'all, cooling out, having a good old time reading this fucking book, and hoping that Alani don't piss me off, okay? Like only she can, because she is a heifer. I'm good, darling. I really am. But yeah, this is usually a pretty tough day for me, but I'm good. I'm faring well, and I'm going to claim that and leave it right there, doggone it. Because listen, the universe is fucking awesome. Do you hear me? It is awesome sauce. So, yes, that's where we at. All right, here we go. Chapter 20. You're so patient with me, Alani whispered as he pulled up to the curb in front of her house. The entire 4-hour ride had been silent. Alani was satisfied in ways she didn't know a woman could be satisfied. She was also moody. She was filled with guilt to the max. She had to will her eyes not to shed tears the entire way while gripping Ethic's hand desperately on the way back to Flint. Thoughts of her daughter ran rampant in her mind while Ethic ran wild and free in her heart. Her soul was at war. It was a tug of war over what she deserved. She couldn't love on a ghost, however. She couldn't wrap her arms around a memory. Ethic was her biggest sin, and she was committed to sinning daily, even through moments like this one, when it hurt. Child, listen. Like I said, she just going back and forth and back and forth like a fucking slow bopper for Christ. I literally cannot with this child. Some days I give you all of me. Others I'm terrified to give you even a piece, and you stay through it all. You keep coming back to love me on days when I don't even love me. You notice and you compensate for everything I'm drained of. She looked at him in amazement. He wiped a hand down the back of his neck and glanced out the window. I'll take whatever you've given me. Anger, love, resentment. I'll eat that. As long as you're here, I felt what it's like to not have you. That can't happen again, he said, without looking at her. What if we're forcing something that was never supposed to be? She asked. Those words jarred his attention. Alani looked down as she fumbled with her fingers. She was inside her head, contemplating one of the biggest moves she had ever made with a man in her life. She wanted him. She wanted him all the time, and pit in her stomach from pulling up to her house was proof enough that he wasn't supposed to be dropping her off at all. He captured her nervous fingers in his palm, bringing her hand to his lips. Is it crazy that it hurts to pull up to my own house? Just thinking about packing up Easy and Bella and handing them off to you and watching y'all drive away without me makes me feel sick, she whispered. Child, listen. Ethic reached one hand across the car to grip the back of her headrest as he turned his body toward her. I thought this was what you wanted. Dating, little distance, pace things out so we can get to know one another, he answered, perplexed. He could feel the tension building in the center of his forehead. Women, they said one thing but meant another. I know you, Ethic, she whispered. She shook her head, confused. She was being bombarded by so many different emotions. Taking shit slow don't mean we're stopping, he said. Ethic wanted to throw caution to the wind and go with his original plan, straight to the next stop, marriage and babies, change her last name and her zip code. But Alani was fickle. She was emotional and damaged. Her needs changed daily. Her intentions changed hourly. He wanted her to be sure. He needed to be sure. The decisions they made affected his children at this point, and he couldn't put them through any more inconsistency. I wasn't with it at first, but Let's just see it through. Let's allow my ear to get us through it, because as much as you try to hide it, I could still see you hate. No, I think he meant I can still see the hate in you. There are words missing. In you or inside you, I don't know. That's the thing with reading on a Kindle, child. Sometimes shit get all jumbled. I don't know what the fuck she's saying. But anyway, you know what he means. Alani sucked in air and held it to try to fill the empty pit in her. I don't hate you. She shook her head in disappointment, in shame. She had handled so many things with him poorly. You don't deserve that. I don't hate you. I hate that you even think that. You can't love someone that you think feels that way about you. He pinched her chin and drew her near, kissing her lips. One quick peck, his full lips meeting hers, then pulling back slightly to lick his lips before kissing her again. His tongue in her mouth reminded her of his tongue in other places, and Alani melted. It don't matter. Hate, love, I want every part, he said. Things play out the way they do for a reason, but me and you, we're going to be fine. What if, he pulled her to him again, silencing her with kisses that made her soul stir. I'm going to make sure we make it this time. That part ain't your job. It's mine. And I'm going to do a damn good job, baby. Trust me, Ethic assured. She nodded. Putting her faith in a man like Ethic was effortless. He did exactly what he said he would. There was no anticipation of letdown with him. No fear that he wouldn't come through. He opened his door and climbed out the car and then walked around the front of the car to get to the passenger side. He opened the door and she stepped out. She led the way up to her home. Home he had paid to remodel. She glanced up the block at all the homes that had been restored because of him, because he had cared enough to make a change to her small community, because he thought her worthy enough to live in a safe, clean environment. Ethic reached the door and turned back to find her standing there, halfway up her walkway, staring at him like he was a beautiful sunset, in awe. You coming? He asked. This nigga here, she thought. He had no idea what he did to her. The natural charisma of him just attracted her. He wasn't cocky or entitled. It was like Ethic didn't even realize how handsome he was. He didn't know that the seat of women's panties moistened whenever he entered a room. She nodded and then joined him, removing her keys from her handbag. She held it up for him and he grabbed it and then opened the door. He held open the door and as she passed him, she said, keep it. I want you to have access to everything. I want to live with you, but until I can, until we're ready, I want you to be able to come and go whenever you want. She gave him a peck on his parted lips and wrapped both hands around his neck as she looked up at him. If you want to stop by for breakfast, you're welcome. Don't call. Just come. She rubbed the back of his neck and then kissed him deeper, pulling his bottom lip into her mouth this time. If you wake up in the middle of the night and your dick is hard, you come through. He groaned as he gripped her ass with one hand. She slipped her tongue into his mouth, feeling him harden against her body. He pulled her into him and she moaned. If you want to come eat my pussy until I scream, you pull up on me anytime, she whispered. How about now? I'm trying to put my face in it now, he groaned. The sounds of Bella and Easy traveled from upstairs and she smiled. Not now. I miss it, but I miss them more, she giggled. She turned and then headed for the living room, leaving him standing there adjusting his dick so that his kids wouldn't see what she had done to him. Hello, she called out. We're back. The sound of feet racing down the wooden staircase filled the air. Yay, they're back, Easy shouted. He ran right into Alani, wrapping her in a tight hug. She laughed and hugged him right back. Get off my woman, homie. I'm starting to think I got some competition, Ethic said, noticing how smitten his son was with Alani. She winked at him as Bella came waltzing into the room with her iPhone in hand, ears plugged with headphones. Hey, Daddy. Hey, Alani, she greeted. Where's Nanny? Alani asked. On the back patio playing cards with Mr. Larry, Bella said. Ethic lifted a brow. Her boyfriend. But if she ever hears you say it, it'll be the last thing you ever utter, Alani snickered. Ethic nodded. Y'all ready? He asked. Can I stay? Bella asked. Or Alani, can you come with us? B, she's busy. We've taken up enough of her time, Ethic interrupted. Out of nowhere, Nanny's voice boomed. She ain't got nothing to do but play hard to get. Quit making that man chase you and get your narrow behind out of here. I'm fine here by myself. I've been getting around just fine without you for 75 years. I don't need no babysitter, Nanny fussed. Mr. Larry followed behind her, coming into view. Nanny walked up to Ethic and kissed his cheek. Hey, handsome, she greeted. Lord knows he broke the mold when he made you. Ethic blushed, and Alani cocked her head back, but she didn't dare utter one word. Ethic, this is Mr. Larry. He's a friend from the church. Larry, this is Ethic, Alani's boyfriend. Alani knew how Ethic felt about the term. It was childish, and it put expectations on them. Nanny, he's not my... Alani, come off it already, Nanny fussed. What? He done got you a ring? Because unless he's your fiancé now, he's definitely your boyfriend. Damn man been your boyfriend since you gave him that pie. I ain't talking about the one I baked either, she said, giving Alani the side eye. What pie? Easy asked. I want pie. Oh my God. Oh my God. Kids are so fucking innocent, yo. Oh my God. Listen, Linda. Okay. Ethic snickered and extended his hand. The older man shook it. Nice to meet you, sir, Ethic greeted. I'm the boyfriend, although I wouldn't mind the upgrade. I like how you think, Miss Pat. Alani blushed. What pie? Easy asked again. Boy, come on, Bella said, as she pushed him forward toward the door. They not talking about pie, pie. They talking about, little girl. Alani interrupted. You better think we talking about pie pie too. Ethic turned his head towards his daughter. What she said, he added, frowning. Bella had been losing her mind lately. He hadn't missed the slick comments she had been making, and it bothered him. She was growing up. Sex and boys and makeup were infiltrating her world. Ethic felt the tension building him, and he rubbed the back of his neck. Bella tucked her lips inside her mouth, knowing when to stop while she was ahead. Walked out the front door. Nanny laughed as she saw the entire bunch to the door. Call me if you need anything, Alani said. I'll be home tomorrow, I guess. Mm-hmm. Bye, child, Nanny said, ushering her out the door. Relax, Ethic whispered as he kissed the side of her head. I'll hire a nurse first thing in the morning. Someone good that you're comfortable with. A nurse? Ethic, it's only for a night, Alani protested. Let me take you home, baby, he said. Just from the way he said it, she knew he was talking about forever. Fuck dating. Moments ago, they had decided to take it slow. Now he was putting his foot on the gas pedal, speeding in the fast lane. Neither Ethic or Alani knew the path to their destination. They didn't even know the speed limit to get there. All they knew was that they should end up together. The destination was love. They were guessing their way there, hoping they would get there in one piece. Alani looked up at him and then out at Bella and Easy as they made their way into the back seat of Ethic's car. Home? She asked. Her heart fluttered. Unsurely, it was such a huge step, such a commitment. Was he saying what she thought he was saying, pushing her into the next level of their relationship? What if we don't make it? But what if we do? He could see the thoughts overwhelming her. With me, with us, he said as he motioned for the truck. Make a home with me, Alani. It's just bricks and plaster without you. Make a man out of me, he said. Alani felt like she couldn't breathe. You just didn't go from a first date to living together. You just didn't. He kissed her lips and she withered under his touch. Her entire spirit glowed with him when she allowed it to. When she let go of the hurt, he was the very best medicine for her ailments. Can we do this? She asked. Out of nowhere, Nanny stuck her head out the open living room window, the one Mr. Larry was there to fix. Yes, damn it. Yes, your difficult ass can do this. Give the man a break. I swear you want to be lonely. Alani's chin hit her chest as Ethic chuckled. Take her ass home, Ezra. Go on now, Nanny urged. I respect my elders, he told Alani with amusement, playing at his lips. She shook her head, smiling, but feeling flutters inside. She wondered if it was her intuition telling her to decline, warning her that this was too big of a step. Nanny had never been one to bite her tongue. She gave no never mind about Alani's embarrassment. I do what I'm told. He took her hand as they headed home to their home together. They were finally giving it a real shot as a couple under one roof. Alani was both excited and terrified. And that's the end of that chapter. I'm so sick of this fucking bitch. Now, if he was trying to put her punk ass on ice, she'd be like, I don't understand why he don't want to move forward with me. He want to take it slow. Oh, God. Weird ass. Man, these hoes. I be trying to give these slow boppers grace. God damn it, they'll be constipating the bitch with this bullshit, man. Is this what y'all be going through? Oh my God, I don't understand it. Do y'all be vacillating, child? Listen, all you got to do is give it a try. If the shit don't work, take your punk ass home. The nigga done bought the whole block for you. Go home. You own the whole block. Find you another nigga. It's just that simple. But damn, all of this back and forth. It's like she trying to jump double dutch. You know how you be hesitating before you get in, trying to let the rope's rhythm become your rhythm? You be trying to become one with the rope before you jump. That's what the fuck she doing. Child, listen. That D should have you feeling so much love and content, Alani. Yeah, you're on your on our day. Yeah, I mean, she should be happy. I don't know, child. I know, right? Mr. Larry, like, let me get on up in there in that sweet potato pie. Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think she's fast, but I mean, she's, you know, becoming a teenager. I don't know. I just, like, I used to hate it when somebody would say somebody was fast. You know, like, oh, sit your fast ass down. How does a kid be fast? They're growing up and they're exposed to things, but yeah. I mean, now I be thinking that some adults be fast, and what I mean by that is that they're moving very fast for, you know, having just met Ray Ray the other day. You don't even know the nigga last name. You don't know his mammy name or his pappy name. Hell, he about don't know his pappy name, but at least you should know his mammy's name. I mean, you know, that's what I be talking about sometimes, child. I don't know. Lord have mercy. Anyway. But y'all be done sucked his dick down to the base and don't know his last name. Chapter 21. Morgan sat inside one of Ethic's old school refurbished cars with her head resting against the leather seat. Earbuds plugged her ears and the music drowned out the hum of the engine. I had high hopes for us, baby, like I was on dope for us, baby, chasing after a high that I'll never get back again. So we turned into 3 long years and it became painfully clear that we would never see those days again. But I guess forever doesn't last too long. Forever doesn't last too long. Forever doesn't last too long these days. She closed her eyes and placed both hands over her heart as she felt the steady thump as it beat. Her face was wet. Messiah had hurt her. It was an overwhelming and unending feeling. She had felt it before when her father had died, then again when her mother had died, then Raven. Why did this feel like death? Messiah's betrayal felt like the end of the world, so why not end it? The exhaust tube that rested in the driver's side window was connected to the tailpipe of the car. She could smell the fumes from the exhaust as it backed up inside the cabin of the car. She was breathing it in. She had done the research. It was the least painful way to go. It would end it all. It would take away the ache and she wouldn't feel a thing. She would just fall asleep. And when her family found her, it would look like she was resting. Easy and Bella wouldn't be afraid if they found her first. Ethic and Alani would come home from their trip to discover what she had done. It wouldn't be gruesome. She would no longer be in anyone's way. It was perfect. Morgan's lips stretched in grief as she sobbed. How someone could pretend to love her so perfectly was beyond her. If his fake love had felt that good, what would his real love feel like? Why couldn't she have him? Why did he have to lie? How could he want to hurt her? She would have never hurt him. Even now, after discovering his deception, she didn't wish him harm. She just couldn't go back to living without him. She didn't want to. Life wasn't the same if he wasn't in it. Morgan grabbed her phone from the passenger seat and went to Messiah's contact information. Her finger lingered over his name. If she could just hear his voice, if he would just answer her calls, she could get out of this car. Just a connection, just a hello would make her feel like she mattered to him. But every time she called, she was sent to voicemail. He doesn't care anymore, she thought. She dialed his number, and this time she wasn't even given the courtesy of a ring. The automated voice came on immediately, as if she had been blocked. Well, girl, you tore up a $100,000 whip. The fuck you thought? Blocked is an understatement. You lucky you wasn't pulverized on that damn concrete out there. But one second, y'all. Sorry, y'all. Morgan's lip trembled, and she placed both hands on the steering wheel as tears trailed down her face. She sucked in a deep breath, inhaling poison, trying to speed up this process. At that very moment, Morgan just wanted her daddy. She wanted to close her eyes and wake up where Benjamin Atkins was, wherever they all were, her family. That's where she wanted to be. Death felt like going home, a reunion that she had avoided for years. Instead of embracing it, she had run from death. She had been afraid of it, feeling like the inevitable would eventually catch up to her. Now she was chasing it. She wished for it because life had gotten heavy. Morgan wasn't like other people. She couldn't withstand this pain. She wasn't strong, not without him. He was her muscle and he was gone. Morgan picked up her phone and went to Twitter. She scheduled a tweet. Every Friday at 1 a.m., she wanted to let the world know Eminem forever. She felt her heart slow, and she clicked out of her phone and then leaned her head back against the seat. Her neck was weak, like her head weighed 1,000 pounds. She sighed as her lids fluttered. Damn, they were heavy too. If I could just hear his voice, if he would just answer. Morgan went to reach for her phone one last time, but her arm was now heavy too, and her heart, damn, that was heavy too. It took so much effort for her to breathe. It took so much effort for her breaths to lift her chest. Hey, Stank. Morgan saw Raven signing to her in her mind. You've got to wake up, Mo. Don't you dare give up. Fight, Morgan. Morgan felt agony suddenly as she was overwhelmed with the urge to push the pipe from the window, but she couldn't move. I can't, Ray. I can't fight. Get up, Morgan. Wake up. This time it wasn't Raven's voice she heard. It was Ethics, and he was screaming it desperately, roaring at her with such fear in his tone that Morgan wanted to listen. It was too late, however. She couldn't. She just couldn't. She had no strength. Her eyes were mere slits as she tried to force them open wide, but she only saw Ethic through a sliver, and then he disappeared as the blackness behind her lids took her under. She was gone. And that's the end of that chapter. Wow. I'm mad she didn't even tell Ethic that she was pregnant. I don't even think Alani know. Ah, childless. Man. Now we gotta read the next fuck. This is bullshit. Let me get this next fucking chapter out the way. Put this shit to bed. I'm like Alani. I know what I'm getting and I'm mad about it, but I still want it. Lord have mercy. Chapter 22. Mo, Bella called as she saw Ethic emerge from the garage carrying Morgan in his arms. What's wrong with her? Bella asked. Mo, oh my God, Alani whispered as she hopped from the passenger side. Ethic, what happened? What happened? Call 911, he shouted as he laid Morgan out on the ground. Alani's fingers trembled as she dialed for help. She handed the phone to Bella. You tell them the address and tell them your sister is here unconscious and we need an ambulance. Bella's eyes watered as she tried to get out of the car. Alani pushed against the back door. Bella, no, she said sternly.
Bella's eyes were gazing past Alani up the driveway to Morgan's body on the ground. Alani snapped her fingers in front of her face, jarring Bella's attention. Bella, this is important. Get help here now. Don't get out of this car. Keep Easy inside. Is she going to be okay? Bella asked, eyes full of tears. Easy stood, gripping the headrest of the driver's seat to try to peek through the windshield. What's wrong with Mo? Alani nodded. I'm going to help her, but I need you to help too by staying here with Easy, okay? Tears rolled down Bella's face as a familiar feeling crept into her soul. Flashes of Raven lived in her. That day, so long ago, when she had been killed. Bella had been young, but it was a day she would never forget. She remembered Ethic crying over Raven, much like he was crying over Morgan now. Raven had died that day, and terror seized her as she wondered if Mo was dying too. Bella, take the phone, baby girl. We need help. Bella took the phone. Alani reached across the seat and hastily opened Easy's backpack. Easy, baby, play with your iPad, okay? She closed them safely inside, behind the dark tent of the truck, and then ran to Ethic and Morgan. Mo, wake up, baby girl. Wake up for me, he pleaded, as he hovered over her, hands on top of each other, as he jerked downward, giving her chest compressions. What happened? Alani shrieked as she came to her knees. Alani's eyes scoured Morgan. She was looking for blood, clues, any indication of what had occurred. Ethic! Alani looked to the open garage and her eyes widened in horror when she saw the makeshift gas chamber. Oh my God, Ethic, she needs oxygen. How long was she in there? I don't know, he shouted. One, two, three, four, five. Ethic counted to 30 in his head, pumping her heart as he gritted his teeth in desperation. He pinched her nose and blew air into her mouth. I'll do the compressions, Ethic. You're pressing too hard. You'll break her ribs, Alani said, but Ethic didn't stop. He was distraught as he tried to make Morgan's heart beat again, pressing harder and harder with every pump of his strong arms. One, two, three, four, five. 30 compressions, hard, forceful blows to Mo's chest because he was filled with angst and needed this to work. He needed her heart to beat, needed her to breathe. Ethic, you're going to hurt her, Alani pleaded. When Ethic moved to Morgan's mouth to give her air, Alani mounted Morgan's body, placing her hands over Morgan's chest. One, two, three, four, five, all the way to 30. Breathe for her, Ethic, she said. Urgently, but in control. She had done this before at the hospice she used to work at. It was second nature for her. Every 30 seconds, you give her air. Two breaths. Alani closed her eyes and prayed as she did the next set of compressions. God, please cover her. Please, please, please. No more losses. God, please. She doesn't deserve this. Alani's eyes burned with conviction. The sirens in the distance did little to ease the tension in Alani's chest. Come on, Mo. Come on, Ethic whispered as he leaned over her, absolutely destroyed. You can do it, baby girl. Just wake up. One, two, three, four, five, all the way to 30. Breathe, Alani whispered frantically. It's not working. She's not waking up, Ethic said through gritted teeth. Baby girl, don't do this to me. Get up, Mo. Ethic's voice was angry, tortured, and the sight of him made Alani even more distraught. She had never thought it was possible for a person to love a child that wasn't biologically theirs, the same way you loved your own. But seeing him like this, Alani knew that Morgan was his child through and through. We just have to keep her heart pumping until help gets here, Alani said, more to herself than to Ethic. Her fear-filled voice cracked. Morgan was so unresponsive, and Alani felt no life energy coming from her. She prayed Morgan wasn't already gone. The ambulance's alarm wailed as it pulled onto Ethic's estate, and as they approached, Ethic said, keep her heart beating for me, Lanika. You have God in you, baby. She needs you. The way he looked at her, the hopelessness, the fear, he was pleading, begging her to help this girl he loved so much. He was depending on her. I'm not a doctor, she thought, fear-stricken, not wanting to be responsible if his oldest child died in her hands. Ma'am, we've got it from here, the paramedic said. Alani kept compressing. One, two, three, four, five, all the way to 30. Her arms burned. She was exhausted, but she couldn't stop. Wouldn't stop because Ethic had asked her not to. She went to Morgan's mouth. Breathe. She blew air into her lungs. The way Morgan's chest rose artificially, only rising because Alani was forcing a spurt of life into her, made Alani's eyes mist. Morgan Atkins, this beautiful girl, a piece of Ethic's heart was undoubtedly lifeless. I've got it. I'm certified. Just do the rest, Alani insisted as she pumped Morgan's chest. Ma'am. Alani glanced at Ethic, who sat on the ground, elbows to his knees, hands on the top of his head in distress, that her heart ached. It bled for him. God, she loved him, and he loved Morgan, so it meant she loved Morgan, too. They couldn't lose her. I'm not stopping. Just do the rest. The paramedics went to work around Alani, hoisting both Alani and Morgan up onto a stretcher as Alani kept the compressions going. She had been at it so long that her arms had Charlie horses and she was sweating, but she continued. Ethic stood, rushing alongside the stretcher, watching Alani's dainty hands tensing against Morgan's chest. He couldn't follow them onto the bed of the ambulance, however. Alani looked up at him, eyes shining in fear, tears on her cheeks, as she kept the count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way to 30. Daddy, Ethic heard Bella screaming for him from the car, but he couldn't tear his eyes off Mo. Ethic, I've got to take care of them. Take them back to Nanny and meet me at the hospital. I won't leave her side until you get there, she promised. He nodded, feeling helpless. He placed both hands on his head, his face wrinkled in agony, eyes clouding, a man destroyed. The paramedics closed the steel doors and the ambulance pulled away with two of his most precious girls trapped inside. And there's a break in the chat. Child, shit, I need a blunt. This fucking girl, I don't even smoke blunts. Oh, my God. All right, here we go. It's 5 minutes left in the book. Yeah, you did tell me, child. This girl just fucking, oh my God. Bella sprang from the back seat of that truck like she was in a race and someone had yelled go. As soon as the ambulance departed, Bella was at Ethic's side. Where are they taking her? What happened to her? Bella cried. She's hurt, B. She hurt herself, Ethic whispered in disbelief. He rushed, ushering her back to the car, but his legs were weakening. He leaned over the hood of his car, hands gripping the edge. Fuck! He shouted, causing Bella to jump and Easy to climb from the truck. His bald fist slammed against the metal as the anguish traveled through him. Daddy? Easy's voice caused Ethic to steal. He could never feel without interruption. He could never just go through the motions of his emotions. They were always concealed, always guarded, always bubbling beneath the surface because he had little eyes watching him, learning from him, depending on him. His son's voice was a reminder, and Ethic reserved himself and stood up straight, sniffing away his worry as he flicked his nose and turned his face to his children. She's fine, big man. Mo's gonna be just fine. Climb in the car, Ethic said. Where are we going? Easy asked. Back to Nanny's, Ethic said. I gotta go check on Mo. I'll be back for you in a few hours. He had done it. He had concealed the storm that was moving through his body to protect his children. Easy was easy to pacify, but Bella stood there looking up at him defiantly. I'm coming with you, Bella said. We can drop Easy off, but I'm coming to the hospital. She's my sister. Ethic nodded, almost losing it, as his chin quivered, and he pulled Bella into his chest, kissing the top of her head as he cried. It's going to be okay, Dad, Bella whispered, as she buried herself into his chest, wrapping her arms around his waist. She's strong. You taught us to be strong. It doesn't always have to be you. Damn it, if Bella wasn't acting like the parent in this moment. Her words put the vigor back in his legs and the hope back in his heart. Ethic kissed the top of her head. He blinked back emotion. Let's go. It's another break in the chapter. Child, if this girl died, I mean, listen, on the one hand, I just want her to go on to be with her mama and her daddy and her sister and take the little baby growing in her belly with her because this girl is just going to be fucked up without Messiah. And if they don't get back together, this is going to be some bullshit. And ain't nobody got time for that. Alani stood outside the glass window, looking inside the room as anxiety ate away at her stomach. The sound of the door opening behind her caused her to turn, and when she saw him, she ran to him, wrapping her arms around him instantly. She quickly pulled back and bent down to hug Bella. Where is she? Ethic asked urgently. She's alive, Ethic. She's breathing. They're giving her hyperbaric oxygen therapy to remove the carbon monoxide from her body. No one knows how long she was there, though, Ethic. There could be
She paused as she looked down at Bella, not wanting to divulge too much. She lowered sympathetic eyes to the floor and took his hands. She leaned into his ear and finished. Brain damage, she whispered. Ethic collapsed into her sobbing. Alani held him, her soft hands rubbing his head and face as she kissed his lips, feeling so broken because he was so broken. His children had been through so much. He had been through so much. It was just one thing after another. Shh, she soothed. Baby, should we pray? Both Alani and Ethic turned to Bella in surprise. If it's that bad, we should pray, right? Little girl, Alani whispered in amazement as she opened up their circle, motioning for Bella to join the embrace. The soul God gave you is miraculous. Alani, Ethic, and Bella stood in a circle, arms wrapped around one another. Alani fixed her mouth to begin, but Bella was already speaking. God, it's me, Bella, but you probably already know that. I'm a little nervous or scared or both. Alani gave Bella's hand a squeeze. My sister needs you. My whole family needs you. You know, I know. You saved people because I prayed for you to save Alani, and you did. Alani looked up at Bella with fresh pools of emotion in her eyes. Bella's eyes were squeezed tight, but Alani felt Ethic's gaze on her. She turned to meet his stare. I prayed for you to save my daddy, and he's still here, too. Then I prayed that they would love one another, and now they do. I just have one more favor, God. Please heal Mo. Please don't let her die. Whatever the doctors are saying might be wrong with her, take it away. Protect our family. We have a lot of hard days. Can you make some of them easier? Please? We need each other, and we just got Alani. You can't take Mo. We just want to be complete. I need everyone to be safe. Amen. Amen, baby girl, Alani said. She let go of Ethic's hand and focused all her attention on Bella as she hugged her. That was a beautiful prayer. You're a beautiful girl, and we're going to be okay. I know it took me a while to come around, but I'm not leaving you or your daddy or Easy or Morgan. Nothing will make me leave ever again. Morgan is going to be fine. God will make us whole. Just trust him. Ethic stood at the window, looking into the room where Morgan was being held inside the pressurized chamber. He gripped the edge and stood with his head bowed, his strong back tense as the weight of the world sat on his shoulders. Alani could see it, the pressure of holding his entire family together alone. It had been his responsibility for so long. One second. Sorry, y'all. All right. It had been his responsibility for so long. A man raising three children. He had just lost his fourth, and now his oldest was in jeopardy. Alani grabbed Bella's hand and led her over to Ethic. She placed a hand on his back as she stepped beside him. Standing between two Okafors, she knew they needed her just as much as she needed them. If Morgan Atkins died, nothing would ever be the same for any of them. Another moth. Another flame. The thought alone paralyzed Ethic. He needed God. He prayed desperately for a miracle because if Morgan never opened her eyes again, Ethic would close his too. A father wasn't supposed to bury his children. His heart wouldn't be able to endure the loss of another Atkins girl. God, please, not again. That's it, y'all. Says to be continued in the final book, Ethic 5. But we all know that's some bullshit because there's an Ethic 6. Yes. I cannot with this apple. Okay. All right, let me see what the fuck Ethic 5 is. Let me read y'all the fucking synopsis, y'all. And this one is 322 Oh, before I even. My food before I even said anything. You know what, Kim Cash? Listen, little girl. Listen. This is some bullshit, yo. Y'all, man, listen. Oh, child. Yes, we rolling through them because I'm a fucking. Ooh, chillax. All right, fuck the bullshit. We getting through 5 and 6 this week, and then fuck ethic, okay? And like, I'm over it. I'm over it. You heard me? I'm over it. Y'all did not even realize. Lord have mercy. Ugh. Y'all don't understand. I'm over here with extra cortisol and motherfucking cholesterol and everything behind this motherfucker. Yes, I'm getting the fuck done over the fucking ethic effect. Okay? We are getting done with this thing. All right, let me get to the fucking you dig. I was already given a yes, so let me. Y'all know what is a good movie? That goddamn Creed 3. I like that fucking Michael B. Jordan. He acted his ass off in that movie. That's a handsome young dude. I like him. He probably a problem child, just like the rest of these fucking niggas. Like, you be looking at him and be like, ooh, they sculpted so perfectly, and they just be fucking trash on the inside. That's the problem with these niggas. They all dookie. It's like, damn. It's like you have to wonder, like, what the fuck? Like, it's a cruel joke. The universe be like, I had to make the motherfuckers look good on the outside. Like, come on now. Nobody would buy a Cadillac if it would look as trash on the outside as it is under the hood. Because argue with your weird ass neighbors. Cadillacs are fucking trash dressed in beauty. That's what the fuck they are. They are bullshit under the hood. Trust me, I've had my fair share of it. Okay? Right. And each one of them was trash under the hood. Boy, they were pretty inside. Right. Pretty on the outside, but under the hood, piece of shit. Mm-mm, child. Electrically fucking stunted is what they are. Just like these. And the universe pulls a cruel joke. Universe, God, higher power, Buddha, Allah, Jehovah, Yahweh, whatever you bow to, whatever makes your knees bend, you heard me? Right. Made these motherfuckers beautiful on the outside. Child, listen. Shit. I do too, right? So I ain't even got to read it. I almost want to ask her to, but fuck. He don't. None of them like black women. I'm not surprised, child. None of these niggas like black women. They may even the ones that date black women exclusively. Still, the ones that marry black women. Listen, they don't like our asses, y'all. We just got. They can't live the fuck without us. But they don't like our goddamn asses. I'm convinced, child. Listen, she said, I'm not telling you nothing, Marva. Y'all can argue with your weird ass motherfucking neighbors. That's all I'm gonna say. Argue with your ugly ass coworkers, okay? Because I ain't telling you what I heard. I'm telling you about what I know about these niggas. I've been on this planet for 54 fucking years, and I'm telling you. The only man that ever loved me correctly, not sexually, but correctly, was my damn daddy. And he dead and gone, so apparently his ass didn't like me that much either. Because he checked up out of here before me. I don't like that shit, so I'm mad at him about that. You should have seen around. But I'm convinced your husbands, your sons, none of them niggas like your ass. Trust me, they don't. It's either the rules or the boundaries that you place. The rules you put on your son, the boundaries you place on your husband make them not like you. They feel like they're supposed to have free reign. They're supposed to say whatever, do whatever, be however, and you just supposed to stay there like a biscuit in a plate full of alligator syrup and just sop it all up. Shit, you lying, you got me fucked up. I will put a bullet in your ass and do my time if that's what's required. Fuck out of here. All right, so No, I didn't say they didn't love us. I said like. Oh, I'm real intentional with my words. Oh, they absolutely love us. They do. They don't have a choice. We're God. Who the fuck doesn't love God? Weirdos, right? I said like. There's a difference. Like, you know, if you're hungry and somebody gives you Brussels sprouts, you'll eat the fuck out of them Brussels sprouts rather than starve, right? I would, and I don't even fuck with Brussels sprouts. Anybody that's been over here in the Speakeasy long enough knows fuck you don't do Brussels sprouts. Fuck that. Okay? You can dress them up however you want to. You can cover them bitches in bacon, and I'll eat all the fucking bacon chips off of them, and you'll have a plate full of Brussels sprouts. Oh, but if a bitch get hungry enough and go without food for long enough, I'll eat the fuck out of some Brussels sprouts. You heard me? But I don't like them. There's a difference. I keep telling y'all, I know what the fuck I be saying. I'm very, very intentional with my words. Very much so. They love us. Some of them want to be us while you bullshit, but they don't like us. That's a conversation for another day, but they don't like us, child. They absolutely love us because we're God. Like, they don't have a choice in that. And I'm not here to convince anybody. You can feel what you want to feel, think what you want to think, believe me or not, the choice is yours. I don't give a good goddamn, but I don't waste time trying to convince others. I'm just telling you, watch how the niggas move. And I'm not saying that from a place of bitterness or anger, but remember, I've been on this planet for 54 years. I used to run in a gang full of niggas. My first husband, may he rest in peace, owned barbershops, beauty salons, and dry cleaners. Niggas talk in those spaces. You think I ain't heard that shit? I got uncles. You know, they play uncles, but they're uncles that are pimps. I'm telling you, these niggas don't like black women. They do not. I'm not here to convince you. Just pay attention to how they move. Love us? Absolutely. Like us? Not so much. That's it. I stand on that. 10 toes down. I'll hand you my uterus. I'll hand you my heart. That's how convinced I am that the words I'm speaking are true, y'all. I promise you. My husband loves me. Does he like me? Not so much. I love him and I like his ass. There's a whole lot of days that I fucking don't. Okay? I promise you. Same thing with my son. He absolutely adores me. Like me? Not so much. Feelings mutual. It's my child, but it is what it is. He another nigga. Just like every other nigga out here. Like I said, I ride hard for my husband and my son. Yeah, because my daddy's dead and in the ground. But like seriously, these men don't like black women. I promise you that. It's a hard pill for some black women to swallow. Because they'd be like, not my man, your man too. Just watch how he treats you when he's angry. Listen to the shit he says when he thinks you're not around to hear him. I promise you, they don't like black women, but they don't like white women either. It's not a black or white thing, y'all. Do they treat white women better? Of course they do, because white women require it. They let them know out the gate, hey, nigga, I'm not suffering with you. That's not my job. That's not my job, but black women, we're always so long suffering with men. Like, look at Alani. Oh, I'll suffer through whatever the fuck he do. Whatever he put me through, I'll suffer through it. I'm not suffering through nobody, through shit with nobody. Fuck out of here. You fuck up, you find out why. It's just that simple. I'm a different type of bitch. I'm cut from a different cloth. That might have to do with learning from one too many pimps. How black men feel about black women. It's not a game, y'all. It's the honest to goodness truth. I wish I was lying to y'all. I wish I was wrong, but I'm not. That's not to say that you can't love they black asses. You just gotta know what you're getting yourself into. And you always gotta stay ready so you ain't got to get ready when the day arrives that you look at that nigga and you realize, God damn, that motherfucking bitch Saki was right. I don't hold any malice or hate in my heart for they black asses. I just don't tolerate they bullshit. The fuck? Listen, these niggas don't like us. It's all right. They some haters. Look at them. Look at black men the same way you look at a hating ass bitch. Because they all the same. They just hating ass niggas with good dick. Some of them got good dick. You know, the way y'all tell it, you know, some of them got good dick. I wouldn't know. I don't have a measuring stick. I happen to think the two dicks I married were great. I could be wrong. Like I said, I could have been getting trash ass dick both times. The world, you never know. Anyway, let's get to this description of Ethic 5. Life has never been easy for Ethic. Since he was a young boy, he has battled loss after loss while struggling to navigate through a treacherous world. When he met Alani Lanika Hill, he knew that he had met the woman who would love him back to life. They've weathered a storm together, and their love is so faded that neither of them want to let it go. But it seems their bubble of happiness is an illusion because life around them is falling apart. When Morgan Atkins attempts suicide, their bliss is shattered. So much is on the line. So many things hang in the balance as Morgan fights for her life. Her broken heart has led her to this, but if she dies, the soul of Ethic's family will be buried with her. In this heart-pounding series, fans have been written into a world of love, lust, anger, sadness, joy, hate, most of all, growth. Hold on tight for another installment of this epic love story told in such a poignant way that it's hard to distinguish the real world from the one in your head. Welcome back to The Ethic Effect. And that's Ethic 5. This is that bullshit. And this funky bitch is paperback. So maybe we won't get through both books this week because oh my God. Child, listen. This is annoying, y'all. I don't even understand why the fuck she did this. And it's books. Let me just check on book six to see if this bitch is paperback too. Because ain't nobody got time for this shit, ma'am. Ain't nobody finna be sitting up here fucking holding a book and shit. Like, what the fuck is wrong with you, ma'am? Let me see. Excuse me, child. All right, sorry, y'all. I think this damn thing is paperback too because it's not letting me download it. This is some bullshit, Jack. Okay, so it's all right. Let me go ahead on and man, this is some fucking bullshit, bro. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and get both of these shipped to the house and yeah, do it that way. Wait a minute. All right, so yeah, I'm gonna have them both just shipped to the house, y'all, and we'll have to finish these up whenever they come, because they talking about free prime delivery June 24th to July 5th. Man, this is fucked up. I was ready. Yeah, but it ain't gonna come fast enough. So, because they won't be here, is saying, what's today's date, John? It said it won't come to the 24th, and that's with the prime. I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. It looks like it's saying that's with the fucking prime thing, because I don't be ordering from the rest of these rascals. That's that bullshit, Jack. I don't be playing like that. I'll figure it out and get him here. I'll try to get him here as quick as I can. But yeah. All right, so that's the bullshit. This is fucked up. So that's all right. The rest of the week, we'll just go back to the Rose Brothers. Cause child, listen. All right, Kim said, you're right. That went right over my head, right? Because they just don't like black women. Child, they say all types of shit. Your niggas be in the barber shop talking cash money shit about your ass. They don't take any accountability or responsibility for anything they do, child. They feel like you're just supposed to understand that bullshit and let them do whatever, say whatever, be however the fuck they want to be. Let them do whatever they are. Let them be fucked up and let them fuck up in peace. I sure will. On the other side of the door, my nigga, because what you won't do, another one of your brethren out there will. Shit. She said, I was doing five things and trying to listen. I got it. Okay. Oh, you back? You back hurting? Yeah, you working too hard. Your back is hurting. No, God. Yes, both of them, five and six, are both paperback. No, it's okay. Just hold on. Don't worry about it. Just wait till I'm done. I'll figure it out. All right. So Kim Cash said, "Long socket your eyes," and you say we're gonna finish both. I can see you now. Said this. Right. Girl, listen, boo, you've been here long enough to know how I give it up. Listen, fuck this shit. Moving on to something else. Child, listen. This shit be making my fucking soul hurt. I don't like back in the day, I didn't do paperbacks once I got to a certain age. I did when I was younger, 10, 11, 12, because those Harlequin romance novels. You know what I'm saying? When you was young and was expecting Fabio to ride up holding a staff and hair blowing and shit. You know what I'm saying? It's fucked up how they fuck little girls up and put them, set them up for the expectation of a white savior. Job, bitch. Ain't nobody coming to save you but your goddamn self. Your savior's in that mirror, you heard me? You better look at that bitch and grow to love her if you don't love her or like her, right? That part. So ain't nobody named Fabio or Eduardo or motherfucking Maison or Messiah or none of them coming to save your ass. You the captain save a hoe, okay? You gotta save yourself, hoe. And that's for real. So I don't like holding on to paperback books and the hardcover books, child. All right, no, hold on, y'all, because this fucking door is trying to lock itself, and I don't think my son closed it tight enough. And she over there talking to me, talking about something is happening with the lock. Damn. Hold on. Lord, Jesus, what's the matter with you, girl? Oh, he didn't close the damn door all the way. So you can finish locking, Miss Mouse. Okay. Damn. There you go. All right. He done left out of here and not closed the door all the way. All right. I'm sorry, y'all. Okay. Oh, Lord Jesus. Little lady was over there just talking, child. I could hear her saying something. I didn't know what the hell she was saying. But she was trying to lock herself back up. I'm like, wait a minute. What is happening? All right. Okay. So I am, once I got to a certain age, I only held or read hardcover books because they're bigger, right? And I would get my little bag of David's sunflower seeds, child, and roll a paper bag down so I could do them seeds, baby. You know, when you're young, you learn how to crack them open, get the seed out with your tongue, and, you know, take the hull out and throw it in the damn paper bag, you know. So, yeah. Because you step on enough dried sunflower seed shards and have them drive into the bottom of your foot, you fucking learn. Let me make sure I put this shit in a bag. Because you know how you try to put them on a paper towel and, you know, yeah. You end up dropping them and shit trying to carry that big ass. Because I would get that big ass of David's sunflower seeds. And child, listen. Because my mama would take me to Super Kmart. And I would get that. They was the only place that had the big bag. And then finally, Omni started having the damn Omni and Venture had the big bags of David sunflower seeds. So yeah. But that's, man, that's a long time ago, child. I was a shorty. But yeah. And so I would sit in the bed and read the hardcover books, child, and be lost in a whole other world, in a whole other dimension. Okay? Listening to these or reading these damn books and hearing the characters in my head, you know, the words that they were saying or whatever. But these damn paperback books now, just, it's not the same. And I don't normally wear glasses, you know, like to see or whatever. So, you know, having to wear them to read, I find it thoroughly annoying. So, but I don't have to do that when I can download the book. Right? Because on the phone, I can make the words as big as I want to. And that's why I said, like, y'all will hear me say, oh, the words are on different pages, right? But, oh, shit. This heifer done got, how you do that? She said, I know you are. Because it didn't show up on the, you dig, as a what you call it. My sister child done got the damn, I don't know how she did that. How you do that? She done got the thing and sent it to my Kindle. Oh, I love you. Thank you. Child, I was like, whatever. I was like, they just gonna have to damn it. Wait. Yes. As soon as you put it in the thing and showed up, I see it. I went back into my thing and it was right there. She always listened to my, oh, you can see it? Yes, ma'am, I can see it. It goes into the whole, just into the thing, period. And then when I open mine, it's just a part of the Kindle library. So it showed up right in my thing. Yeah. So it's in, because it wasn't letting me get it. It was saying only paperback. So I'm not even sure how that happened. And now it's trying to ask me, do I want the butterfly? No, fuck a butterfly. No, we're not doing that shit. After these ethic books, we are done with this nigga. Mm-mm. No, go to hell. I am three kinds of ignorant. No. Mm-mm. Oh, I told her thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tata. But yeah, this is insane. I don't even understand. I don't know what the hell the rest of this is. Let me see. We'll try to see book six so I don't have to wait. Because it was all saying all paperback for me. Oh, I get it. I think it was doing it all. See, I told you this is why I don't like to fuck with this shit. Because it was looking at it all in what you call it. I can't stand your ass. Because listen, she done already did Okay, so we got five and six now. Damn, I was looking forward to that little break. Look, just like a nigga. Damn, I was looking forward to that. So that little break, hey, break. Okay, so we got book five, and apparently book six, because I just yeah, there you go. All right, so we got them both. Right, she said, hell no breaks. That's exactly what the hell she said. Oh, thank you. I love y'all right back. And I love her, and she already know it. Okay, so y'all, we will I might decide to come back out here this evening after the after I get through with Denta. And give y'all a little something. You know, like a first, maybe the first couple of chapters or something. Because I can't start it right now during this live stream, because this is the live stream for book four. So, so y'all know we got it. And that's it. And honey, we are going to finish both of these books this week because, yeah, I'm not finna fuck around. You heard me? As my grandma used to say, Lord willing and the creek don't rise, baby. Yes. We will be finishing this job because I am done. No, look at Kim Cash, thirsty begging ass. I can't give you the first chapter now, but I will later on. Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. She's talking about I'm being greedy. Yeah, I'm gonna come back. It's probably gonna be like about 6 or 7 my time. So if I come back at 6, let's say 6:30 my time, wait, it's Monday. It's something that I'm supposed to watch that comes on Monday long before I commit to that. Let me see. I wish it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'm cool. I can do it. All right. So if I come back at like 6:30 my time, right? That's 7:30 on the East Coast. That's 5:30 Mountain Time. And that's 4:30 all the way out there on the West Coast in Weirdo Land. Okay. Right. Just so y'all know. Okay. So yeah, I'll come back at like 6:30 my time and give y'all a couple tree chapters, a couple tree, and see what that's giving. Because it seemed like all of these chapters, let me see how many damn chapters this book got. I'm over 23. Child, listen. Well, I guess she was thinking that, that this would be the final one. She didn't realize that she would be doing a whole another one after that. Okay. Yeah. All right. So I'm gonna get off of here, y'all, and make the damn thumbnail for Ethic 5. And then we'll come back at 6:30 my time. So I'm gonna make that thumbnail right now. I gotta get my verbiage together and make my little thumbnail. Okay? So y'all go and cool out and catch up on, I guess, whoever else it is that y'all be watching on these YouTube streets, and then I'll see y'all back here at 6:30. Be on time or I'm locking the damn door. Okay? Whoever ain't inside at 6:30 ain't getting in. How about that? Because y'all don't be respecting my damn boundaries. Y'all be cheating me just like black man. Y'all love my ass, but y'all don't like me very much. Y'all don't be respecting my boundaries. Oh, shit. All right, so listen, let me quit acting a fucking fool out here, child. I'll see y'all back here at 6:30, okay? Thank y'all so much for finishing up Ethic 4 with me. Wait, she talking about Cisco had the back door. Go had a back door open for us. Let me tell you something. She bet not hold the back door open. She bet not hold it open. I'll wring her damn neck. Y'all listen. Nah, you know I'm gonna let y'all in. But I will be back here at 6:30, okay? Thank y'all for finishing up Ethic 4 with me. Child, that was a whole lot of crazy fucking fun. It was annoying. It was a roller coaster ride, but that damn ethic, even Messiah. Come on, Messiah, to come back and anyway, I don't know what I hell, I'm just like that damn Alani. One minute I want his ass gone, and the next minute I want him to come back so I can read about him drilling and spilling all up in somebody. Child, listen, that's crazy. Anyway. Y'all go ahead so y'all can get back here. Make sure you done got your food done and all that so you can be in here like you supposed to. Yes, I gave you the weirdo land time. Yes, weirdo land with the IEP phones. Yes. Bye. Bye, Marva. All right, listen, y'all. I'll see y'all back here. Thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all make sure y'all like the video on y'all way out the door. And if you do nothing else, please look for the thumbnail. Give me about 20 minutes. It takes me about 20 minutes to slap all that together. All right. So look for the thumbnail. And please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until 6:30. Bye, y'all.